So, officially, welcome to the U.S. Stock Markets Online Course 2.0. So, we're starting fully with, we're going to start with the mindset, because that is where it all begins from and everything. So, when you are investing in the stock market, you are more like, you are actually investing in companies. You are investing in companies. And that is one of the major differences, because, okay, in the financial market, you have the cryptocurrency, you have Forex, and you have the stock market. So for Forex, you are investing or you are trading currency pairs. You don't actually invest in Forex, you trade Forex. So you trade a currency pair, maybe the US dollar as against the British pound, you are trading it. In crypto, you can invest in a cryptocurrency, or you can, no, you can invest in a coin, or you can trade a coin. So it depends on the coin you're interested in and everything. In stock market, you can also invest in stock market, and you can also trade a stock. So what happens in the, what happens in the stock market is that when you're investing in a company, you are focused on the growth of the business. Are you guys listening? Can you guys hear me?
At the point. Yes, we lost at the point.
Hello, can anyone hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Okay. So,
yes, yes.
So, like I was saying, for the stock market, you are investing in the growth of a business. And as I said, the employee mindset is kind of different from the business owner mindset.
I didn't get that.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes, you can hear me.
For the stock market, they do what?
Okay, for the stock market, you are investing in a company. You are investing in the shares of a company. So when you hear shares, there's a place that you hear shares, you hear equity, and you hear stock. They mean the same thing. So you can ideally say, there are some media outlets that when they are talking about business news, they say, okay, let us talk about the equity market. So they are referring to the same thing. Equity, shares, stock, they mean the same thing.
Hello, so, hello, sir.
Yeah, can you?
Yeah, is it possible for people to mute until maybe when anybody wants to say anything, they signify, because there are noises in the background.
Okay, I think, let me mute.
So maybe when they want to talk, they just, yes, they should signify and you unmute whoever needs to.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
so I've already muted everyone. So if you have any question or anything, just raise up your hand, or you send a message in the chat room so that the background noise will not affect everyone. So, like I was saying, in the stock market, you are investing in shares of a company. So there are different companies. You have Tesla, Amazon, Google, so many companies. So it's more like you are getting a piece of the company. Because now, for people, I've been saying that, yes, you cannot be financially free with a 9-to-5. They will say, get a business. They say, okay, a salary is a bribe to blah, 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 all those things. They say, get a business, run a business. That the billionaires, that the wealthy people, they are not salary earners. They are business people. They are fine. That is okay. That is correct. But it doesn't tell the full story. Because, example now, the CEO of Coca-Cola is an employee. Coca-Cola is paying him. He has a 9-to-5. But still, he's an investor. He has over 100,000 shares of Coca-Cola. So you can actually be an employee and still be an investor. So it's not until, because let us face the truth, starting a business is very difficult, especially in Nigeria. We know what happens in Nigeria. We know all the stories and everything. So growing a business in Nigeria is really difficult. It can be challenging and everything. Now, it's not everybody that is cut out for the entrepreneurship life. There are some people that if you tell them to start a business, to fumble, the business will crash. But you start a business and tell them to run the business or to be an employee, they will deliver perfectly. So it's not until you have a business or you become an entrepreneur before you can succeed. So get, even if you are an employee, you have a 9-to-5, be at that 9-to-5, then let your money be working for you. You can still be an investor even with your 9-to-5. As a business owner, you can still be an investor. You let your money work for you, because you cannot just be working every day of your life. You need rest, you need a time off, you need vacation, those other things. So if your money is not working for you, or if your money is not growing in an investment, it would be that for every time you need money, you would have to work. You don't need to work before you get some money. So that's where investing comes in. Now, there's, like I said, there's a thin line between trading and investing. Now, most people, when they hear about either stocks or something, they think it's just trading. They focus on the charts and everything that, okay, you have to know about the technicals, the price charts. So when you are trading, you are focusing on the movements in the price of a stock. So the shares of a company, it comes at different price. So for example, let's say Apple now, the fruit Apple is the entirety of a company. So you cannot necessarily buy Apple. You may not be able to buy the entire company, but still you can get a piece of the company. So if you cannot buy the full Apple, then just get one part of the Apple. So whatever is happening to the entire company, it will be happening to me too. As the entire company is growing, that's my little piece is growing. For example, now, Apple is currently valued at $2.something trillion. Meaning that if somebody wants to acquire Apple or someone wants to buy the entire company, you have to bring $2.something trillion, which is almost impossible to bring out. But still, you can get a piece of ownership of that company. So I don't have money to buy the entire Apple. I have just $50. I have just $100. Let me buy into the shares of this company. So as I buy into the shares, this company is using my money for business. So it's just more like typical investing. Sorry. Okay. I think someone is trying to log in. Okay. I bet I did tell them. So like I said, you are getting a piece of the company. So as the company grows, your investment is also growing. If the company goes down in value, your investment also goes down in value. So you don't really need to understand the price movements. That is what trading is all about. Because traders, they don't really focus on the business itself. They focus on the technical part. That's where you hear some charts, they look at it, you hear things like candlestick and everything. So with that, they only focus on the price movements. So a stock gains by 2%, 3%, 5%. They are taking their profit immediately. Now, if you are an employee, I would not advise for you to be a trader. Because trading itself is more like a full-time job. It can be exhausting, it can be demanding, because you really need to analyze a chart, all those candlestick and all those things. You analyze it, you can be able to predict that, okay, this stock, as this, it will still drop to this level. Once it drops to this level, I'll buy, then I'll put my stop loss, take profits, all those technologies. So they are for traders, not necessarily for investors. Being an investor doesn't mean you will not need that, but okay, let me make it a bit clear to us. When you are investing, you are focused on the growth of the company. Can you guys hear me? I want to be sure that my internet is not misbehaving. Okay, thank God everyone can hear me. Don't make sure that it's not. Okay, thank you. Thank you. So when you are investing, you are focusing on the growth of that business. How will the business perform the next 3 years, in the next 5 years or something? You need to focus. And What you look out for when you're focusing on the growth of a business differs when you're just focusing on trading. Because trading, you need, there's something that they call volume. How many people are buying a particular stock at a particular time? That is volume. They also look at the charts, all those bars that you see and everything. It is not really for investors. It's for traders. So they are focused on the price movements. Okay, stock is $10. We need to go to, we need to drop to $8 so that I'll buy. So that when I buy at $8, when it rises to $12, I would sell. That is a way of life. So there are two ways to make money. And for those who have read the book, and that's the reason why I said we should try and read the book before this class. So if you've read the book, you would see where I talked about the battle of stock market tacticians, when I gave the analogy of Mourinho and Guardiola. So they are just two different styles. It's not necessary that one is better than the other. It's not necessary that one is better than the other. They are just two different styles of making money. Because the purpose at the end is to make money. That's the reason why you're in the market in the first place. You are there to make money. So you can either make money by trading or you make money by investing. Investing is not better than trading. Trading is not better than investing. It depends on what you are comfortable with. There's a people that are not really comfortable with trading. They're not really concerned that, okay, is at this price now? Will it drop to this one? There's people that, okay, let me just buy this stock and monitor it. I don't really want to be bothered about the day-to-day movements, because if you are looking at the market every day, you may not really get the full picture. You may not really get the full picture because it can be down today and it is up tomorrow. It can be down for 2 weeks straight. But when you look at the bigger picture, it is up for the last 1 month. So for example, a stock has been down for maybe by 20% in the last 2 weeks. Just looking at that, you might feel that, ah, this company is bad, this stock is bad. Why is it down 20%? I'm losing money, everything. But when you now look at the bigger picture, you now see that, okay, in the last 3 months, it has been up by 50%. So it is down 20% today for the past 2 weeks. But in the past 3 months, it is up by 50%. So with that, you know that there's nothing really wrong with this stock. So it's just a daily movement. So, because the daily movement can be, at times, it doesn't tell the full picture of the performance of the stock. Now, when you are to buy a stock, for example, there are two ways to make money. It's either through capital appreciation or dividend yield and everything. Because capital appreciation is when you are predicting that the price will go up. So you buy a stock at, let's say, $10, for example. Then the stock increases to $40 and you now decide to sell. So there's a profit of $30, if you agree with me. You bought it at 10, you are selling at 40. So you have a profit of $30. That is one way to make money in the stock market. Another way is through dividends, whereby you buy a stock, then every quarter or every quarter you get some dividends. In the way, I'll be making reference to the book, The Stock Market Millionaire, and that's why I wanted us to read it. So in that book, I've sent the book to everyone. So even if you've not read it, after the class, please go and read it. You'll get some better clarity. So in the book, I gave analysis of Ikeja's Mall. So it's more like renting. Dividends is more like rent. So example, you build a house or you buy a property for maybe 20 million. 20 million now you bought that property and you want to put it out for rent. Obviously, you cannot be renting that house for 20 million. It's not possible. So you bought the house for, let's say, 20 million naira. The renting may now differ. Maybe it's 300K per year or something. So that's how dividends is. So you buy a stock for maybe $20, is maybe $30, and you're getting dividends. So the dividends that you would get, it depends on the number of units you have in a stock, because dividends is a percentage let's say there's some stocks that is 2% dividend yield. So for every unit you have, get 2%. There's a way it works, that 2% dividend. So that is, so. So the for the dividends, as I was saying, for the dividends, you get a little percentage from the stock every quarter. Most dividend stock in US is every quarter. So quarter, that's why usually have quarterly reports, quarterly earnings. Quarterly earnings. Okay, yeah, can for the disable. I'll just admit it. So you have quarterly earnings and everything, so you get some dividends. Now, when you are starting, I would assume nobody here has started investing. Although some have started, but let's just, for the sake of this class, let's assume nobody has started. So when you are starting with investing, you should focus on two different things. There are two angles to it. It depends on your age and your risk tolerance. That will determine which strategy you go for. Because there are some people that buying dividend stocks suits their personality. It suits their age bracket. It suits their temperament. Because not everybody can handle volatility of a stock. And dividend stocks tend to be less volatile. Dividend stocks, they tend to be less volatile because they've, okay, this is how dividend work, for example. So dividends is when a company is making money, they give part of the profit to their shareholders. That's what dividends is all about. So maybe they generated, for example, let's say $500 million every quarter, for example. That's their profit. So they give part of the profit to their shareholders. That's what you get as dividends. That dividend stocks and their capital appreciation stocks. Now, most capital appreciation stocks don't give dividends. If you, for those who check, Tesla stock doesn't give dividends. Tesla doesn't give dividends. Why? Because Tesla is still growing. Most dividend stocks, okay, let me break it down this way. Look at dividends as more like promo. You know all these companies now, Niger companies, you hear promo, like example, N10, they are doing seasonal surprises, they are doing giveaways, they are doing promo and everything. A company that is starting up cannot afford to be doing promo at the beginning because they are still growing. They need every money, they need as much money as they can get to grow the company. So when they are growing, any money that they make in revenue, they pump it back into the business. So the likes of Tesla, for example, any money that they make, they invest it back into the business. They are not giving out because they still need to grow. So once they've grown to a particular level that, yes, they are now buoyant, they are now okay, they now have sufficient money, they can now afford that, okay, let us be rewarding our shareholders with dividends. Then the board of directors will now decide on how much dividends they will pay per share. And everything. Are we together? Please, are we together? Let's send some message in the chat room so that I will be sure that I'm not talking to myself. Okay, so as I was saying, dividends more like you're investing for capital appreciation stocks, you are putting the money back into the business. So for capital appreciation stocks, investors cannot make money from dividends. So what do? They sell the stock at a higher price. So they buy, I'll just use basic example. So let's say they buy at $20. They know that this company doesn't give dividends yet. So when the company now grows, depending, they can decide, okay, that's grown by $30, it's now $30 or it's now $40 or whatever it is, let me sell, I've made some money. But for some dividend store, you can decide that, okay, I put my money there, then be getting quarterly dividends. It suits me. So there are different angles. Both works. But there's a recommended approach. In one of my posts on social media, I said that You can't start investing and the first thing you are looking out for is dividends. Especially when you have little money. Maybe you are starting with $50. You can't start with $50 and the next thing you are looking to buy dividend stocks. You need your money to grow. Not like dividend stock doesn't grow. Dividend stocks doesn't grow, but the rate at which they grow differs. Let me share my screen to give some example so as would understand what I'm talking about. So we're going to, can you guys see my screen? Can you guys see my screen? Then, and the shorter distance. This is loading. Come, let's see. No, I just need something. Can you guys let me turn on it? Make sure I'm not talking to myself. Deborah, can you hear me? Trying to unmute you guys. Sorry. Okay, Shane, thank you. Thank you. Okay, Shane. Okay, I just wanted to be sure. Please. Finally. Technology can be annoying sometimes. Okay, yes. So I think we can see it now. So let's take, for example, Coca-Cola stock. Okay, yes, I think I can see myself. So let's take a look at Coca-Cola stock. So I just want us to understand the difference in the growth stock and dividend stock, so that would understand what I'm saying. Okay, now you guys can see Coca-Cola stock, right? So I'm going to have a look at the 5-year chart. How has this company grown in the last 5 years? So Coca-Cola is a dividend paying stock. So I don't want to give that difference between dividends and growth stock. So the price of Coca-Cola now is $57. So let's look at the 5-year chart to see how it has grown in the last 5 years. So we'll understand what I'm saying. Good. So in the last 5 years, Coca-Cola has grown by 30%. Just 30%. Imagine somebody getting 30% profit in 5 years. That's like suicide. 30% in 5 years is kind of nearly stupid. So Coca-Cola stock has grown by 30% in the last 5 years. The reason that is that it is already stable. Coca-Cola is over 100 years. So they've grown so much that they are now stable. Not like it will not still grow, but the rate at which it would grow is slow. So it's just going steady. It's already stable. And it's not really volatile. So you can't just see Coca-Cola dropping maybe 10%, except if there's a market crash. There's a market crash. So that's why, okay, during the there's a football competition, Euros, the Ronaldo situation that they said because Ronaldo moved to Coca-Cola, then it affected the stock. It didn't affect the stock. It didn't affect the stock. So that was just like a marketing gimmick. Coca-Cola has grown by 30% in the last 5 years. Now let's take, for example, let us look at Tesla. Tesla is a growth stock. They don't pay dividends. They are still growing. So let's look at Tesla. Look at Tesla. Now, this is Tesla stock. So let us look at the five-year chart of Tesla to see how far it has grown. Remember, Coca-Cola, that is the dividend stock, it has grown by 30%. That's just an example. Some are higher than that, but that's one of the popular and best dividend stocks. So that's why I use that as an example. So let's look at the five-year chart of Tesla to see how far it has grown. So you really need to understand that there are dividends and there are capital appreciation, more like growth stock. So this stock is still growing. They can't afford to be. Now look at Tesla, for example. Tesla has grown by 1,270% in the last 5 years. You can never see this kind of thing, this kind of growth in a dividend stock. It's not possible. It's not possible. So this is a capital appreciation stock, for example. So let's say somebody bought Tesla at this price. Okay, in May 2019, Tesla was $42, for example. May 2019, Tesla was $42. So imagine somebody bought at that period and now Tesla is $643. You can decide that, okay, I'm comfortable. Let me sell, and it takes off a massive profit. So those are the two examples. So let me stop my share for now. So you can either get capital appreciation or dividends. So after that, I'm going to explain what you should look out for, which one you should go out for starting. Okay, thank God. That was, so now, most of us here, I don't think there's anyone that is up to 45, 50. Yes, so maximum, everybody's less than that. So, like I said, you consider your age when you're investing to know which one to go out for. So, while you are still young, maybe you are less than 40 and everything, you should focus more on growth stocks so that you would have more time for it to grow. You buy, so you can't just be at the starting, you are looking for dividend stocks to buy. You should consider growth stocks. You should consider growth stocks. I don't have any dividend stock in my portfolio. And also, you should take note of the money you are using to invest. For example, let's say somebody has $100,000. You can afford to buy dividend stock because no matter the percentage, you would get some very good earnings. But someone is putting $20 in a dividend stock, how much do you get? Is it 0.something dollars? So you can see that while you're starting, you should focus more on the growth stocks. Focus more on the growth stocks. So those are two ways you make your money, either through the capital appreciation stocks or dividends. But it's always recommended while you are young and you're starting, go for the growth stocks. Now, let me talk a brief about the starting points. For example, the platform I use is Bamboo. There are various platforms. There's Bamboo, there's Trove, and there's Chaka, but I'm comfortable with Bamboo. Now, the minimum to start with Bamboo is $20. And that is one of the beauty of the US stock market, or stock market generally. The barrier to entry is pretty low. So even someone in secondary school can start investing. Because $20 is just 10,000 naira. At one point or the other, we've had 10,000, multiple 10,000, tens of thousands of naira. So the barrier to entry is low. So you can start with 10. Although me personally, if someone asks for my recommendation that what should I start with, I'll listen to that. At the very least, start with $100. The minimum is 20, but me, I always advise to start with 100, because $100 gives you a kind of a, will I say, stability to start with. Now, let me give you two scenarios so you understand the difference. So let's say me and Emmanuel, we both start investing in stocks. So I put $100, I'm starting with $100, Emmanuel is starting with $20. The two of us, we bought Tesla stock at the exact same time. I bought Tesla, he bought Tesla. I put in $100, he put in $20. Now, let's say for a period of 6 months, Tesla has grown by 50%. And two of us decide that, okay, let us take our profit at the same time. 50% of $100 is how much? Someone should type in the chat session. 50% of $100 is how much? $50, thank you. Now, 50% of $20 is how much? It's $10, thank you. So, me and Emmanuel, we bought the same stock at the same time. We got the same percentage increase. But me, I made $50, Emmanuel made $10. What was different? The money we put in. So we got the same thing, the same time, but me, I'm making $50 in profit. Emmanuel is making just $10. So even though the minimum is $20, I always advise people, like if someone says, okay, which one should I put? I said, fine, you can start with $100. If you have $1,000 to start with, all well and good, beautiful. If you have $2,000, $5,000, the bigger, the better. If you have $20,000, you're a rich man, you don't need to be here. So you can start. So, but the minimum is 20. So there's the barrier to entry is very, very low. So that's another thing you should consider. And also, like I said at the beginning, that if you have a job or you have a business and everything, focus more on investing. So you buy for the long term. Now, long term is kind of a big word. Let me explain. Like I said, there's always volatility in the market. Nothing just goes up forever. Nothing. Even the Coca-Cola stock that I showed you, if you observed, there was a kind of drop at a period, one kind of big drop. So that big drop happened early 2020 during the market crash when the pandemic started, and it was declared that the coronavirus is a pandemic, the market crashed. So stocks don't just go up on a straight line. It's impossible. So it goes up at a period, it drops down. Because you are not the only one in the market. There are some people, even if you have $100 in a stock, there are some people that in that same stock, they have $2 million. There are some people that they have $200,000. So you can't expect a stock growing by 50%. 50% of $200,000 is $100,000. You can't expect that person to not want to take his profit. You can't expect someone that has $2 million that has grown by 50%. You can't expect him not to take his profit. He would want to, because that's big money. $1 million, that's big money. So at a period of time, some people take their profits off. So definitely, and once they take their profits off, the stock kind of goes down, because there is demand and supply the market. When the demand for a stock is higher, the price would go up. This is basic economics. So, for example, this is my shirt now. Let's say I want to sell this shirt to everyone in this Zoom meeting. And I'm selling it for maybe $20. I like it. I like using dollar currency. So let's talk Naira. We're an happy people. So I want to sell this my shirt for $20. It's on sale. Manu wants to buy it. Chima wants to buy it. Taiwan wants to buy it. Everybody. I was like, okay, everybody wants a shirt. Increase it to $50. Let's say Emmanuel is only $20 that he has. As I've increased it to $50, he has already been cut off. So as I say $50, everybody still wants to buy it. Bukola wants to buy it. Everyone wants to buy it. And I increase it to $100 because there's more demand on this shirt. So I can afford to increase the price as I wish. That's how the stock market operates. Once everybody wants to buy a stock, the stock goes up. There's more demand for that stock. Now, the reverse is also the case. When there is less demand of a stock, nobody wants to buy the stock. Nobody's rushing the stock. The price goes down. It goes down. So, using this shirt as an example, I want to sell the shirt for $100, for example. Nobody's coming. I said, okay, nobody's coming. Nobody wants to talk. Let me reduce it to $50. Nobody wants to buy because the demand is low. I reduce it again to like $20 and I say, okay, people are not coming. Okay, Omolola wants to buy. This is it. And that it happens with even the regular traders. That's why people price, you can price a particular thing. If you go to the market now and you want to buy maybe a particular clothes, and the trader is saying it's 10,000. You say, it's not 5K. It doesn't agree. You say 5K, it doesn't agree. You walk away. If there's no really demand and the trader knows that people are not really demanding this stock, you say, oh yeah, bring the 5K. Because there's less demand for that clothes. So it would have to reduce the price. It gives you for 5K. But for example, you want to buy a shirt and the trader tells you 20K and you're trying to price 5K. He will not answer you because he knows that there are more demand for this for the clothes. If you do not buy, someone else is coming to buy. You can even decide to increase the shirt to 30K. People will still buy. So it's the same thing with the stock market. When there's more demand, people buy a stock. The price of the stock goes up. Now, what is causing that demand? It brings me to the next point of this discussion. Factors that affect the rise and fall of a stock. Because something doesn't just happen for anything. Things don't just happen. When the stock is going up, there are some factors that is making that stock go up. When it's going down, there are some factors. Now, the factors can be divided into two. Let's say three. For those who have read the Stock Market Millionaire, you didn't know about these factors, but for the sake of this discussion, I'll explain it again. So you have the fundamental factors, you have the technical factors, and you have sentiments. Fundamental factors, technical factors, and you have sentiments. When you have an understanding of these three, you can be able to analyze why the market is down or what is up. Now, fundamentals has to do with, I call it insider, internal factors, because it is what the company does that affects the price. Any decision that the company makes internally. So in a way, they are, let's say they are the custodian of their destiny. Let me use it that way. It's what they do. Any decision that they make, any announcements that they make, it will affect the stock. It will affect the stock of the company. So for example, let's say they sign, let's say Tesla signs a new partnership. I'm just using Tesla because Tesla is popular. I'm trying to use popular companies that understand. If I mention some of my favorite stocks now, may be confused. So that I'm using Tesla and Coca-Cola because it's easy to relate to it and we know about them and everything. So let's say Tesla signs a partnership with another company. So okay, Tesla is into electric vehicles majorly. So let's say they sign a partnership with another company to supply them maybe the materials they use for just a kind of big partnership. And that partnership is huge to the company. It will make Tesla to go forward. It will make the business to go forward and the company to grow. It would affect the stock price because there'll be optimism that investors feel that, okay, this partnership is huge for this company. There will now be demand for the stock because people don't want to be left out. People don't want to be left out. So like, okay, there will now be more demand for the stock. And that is because, like I said, it's an internal factor. It's the company that made that decision. It is not the government. It's not Buhari. It's not Joe Biden that made the decision. It's the company. So one of the things that affect the stock price is, for example, management. Management is really crucial to the success of any stock in the market. Because the management that controls the M of our case, they are the one that made the decision, they are the one that signed the deals and everything. So if a company brings in, adds more people to their management team, it would affect the stock. It would affect the stock. Just recently, there's this company. We might not know it, but let me just mention it. It's called Lumina. So they are into is a kind of EV, electric vehicle related company. So they're into this laser and everything for self-driving cars and everything. So they brought in people from Uber, I think Tesla, some other top experienced people to be part of the management team. That alone made the share price to go up because there's an optimism that, okay, we have more experienced people in this company. They are going to make decisions that will take the company to go forward and price increases. There was a time last year that Virgin Galactic is a space company owned by Richard Branson. For those who are familiar or who observed or who heard the news a few weeks ago, he went to space. How many heard that story? You heard that Richard Branson, Virgin Galactic, they went to space. Let me see. Okay, Mr. Wale, thank you. Another person? Nobody heard about it. Okay, no problem. So the company last year, at the point, they kind of signed one of the former CEO of Disney. I don't really know him and everything, but that news, that appointment made the stock go up because for whatever reason, that guy is valuable to the company. So management factors, then you also have earnings reports. Like I said, you are investing in a business. When you are investing in the stock market, you are buying shares of a business, and business are there to make money. Companies are there to make money. It is the process by which they are making that money that now determines the success of that stock. So if they are making profits, like, okay, every quarter they just release their earnings reports. Like I said, they release quarterly earnings. So, and their analysts, they usually predict because people study a company. And that's one thing with when a company is going public. When a company is already public, the financials and everything is accessible to everyone. So people analyze the company, they look at the business structure and everything. They look at the partnership of the company, which I'll talk about one part. You guys should remind me, analyst report and how it affects stock. So in case if I forget, you guys just remind me, analyst report and how it affects stock. So when they study this company and everything, they can be able to predict that, okay, in this quarter, we're expecting Tesla to generate maybe $300 million for this quarter. That is analyst report and everything. So they are predicting that Tesla will make $300 million. If Tesla now makes $310 million, they've exceeded benchmark. They exceeded what people were expecting to make. That alone can affect the stock price to go up, because it means that this company is making more money than what people expected. So there will be demand for the stock. Okay, people want to buy Tesla now. The price is going up. Another thing is product launch. So you hear that Apple is releasing new iPhone 14. Samsung is releasing this product. This company is releasing this product. All those things could affect the company. It will affect the share price, because they are in business. Those are the factors that affect the overall sales of the company. Because like I said earlier on, The purpose is to make money. Every company that is listed on the stock exchange is they are profitable for profit organizations. Note that some companies that you hear is a non-profit organization. You have NGO, so those ones that are not there to make money, they are just organizations and everything, more or less maybe some other stuff. But any company that is listed on the stock exchange, they are there to make money. So all the process that requires you making money, it affects the stock. So management, so the products launch, because they are selling something. These companies are selling something. So when they make more money, there will be demand for the stock. That is the fundamental part. Like I said, it is internal. It is not Joe Biden that will determine if Apple should release iPhone 16 or not. It's Apple that is making that decision. They are done that is determining who they appoint to be in the management team. They are done that is determining which products they would release, which partnership they would release. Talking about partnership, let me give you guys a question. So if, for example, in Lagos, there are big companies, big hotels, like five-star hotels. You have the likes of Eco Hotel, Sheraton, Intercontinental, Oriental, and everything. So let's say, for example, they want to hire the services of a caterer. So maybe they want to do their AGM, their annual general meeting. So they need a caterer, someone to supply them food. And they want to make a decision. And they have two prospects, caterer A and caterer B. So caterer A has a track record. Okay, it is a hotel that wants the service. So caterer A has a track record of doing business with Federal Palace Hotel, Sheraton, Oriental, Intercontinental, and Transcorp. So they have a track record of doing business with five big hotels. On the other hand, caterer B, the biggest they've done is Sheraton. Now, if you are the CEO of a hotel, you want to hire a caterer to supply, who would you go for? Is it caterer A that has track record of doing good business with five big hotels, or caterer B that is just Sheraton that they've done business with? Who would you go for? You're the CEO. Sorry, please, who is TechnoSpark for? Can you rename? So that I don't want to call you TechnoSpark for, I want to mention your name. So can you, because you're raising your hand and I don't know whether you want to ask a question or something. Can you just send a message to the chat soon? TechnoSpark for, please rename your name so I'll not be calling TechnoSpark for. I don't know what your name is, but you're raising up your hand. So yes, everybody's saying Kitra A, they have a track record. And that's one of the things you should look out for in a business. What is that track record? The more successful they are, the better the chances of investing. Now, I said those are fundamental factors. Okay, Priye. So you're raising up your hand. Do you want to ask a question or something? Let me know if you want to ask a question, Priye. If it's a question, let me know so that I would unmute you. Please, if you have any question, you can be asked, because it will also help redirect my discussion. So if you have any question, just send it in the chat room. I would unmute you to ask. So you don't have to wait until the end of the class. If you have any question, just send a chat. I would unmute you so you ask a question. So, like I said, those are the fundamental factors. It is internal. This is what the company does. Now you have the technical factors. These are external factors that affect the movement of a stock price. Now, for the external factors, I call it external, just to make it simplified. This one, in a way, the company has no power. For the fundamentals, I said that it is what the company does that determines the growth of the stock, whether management, products, and everything, or partnership. So in technical factors, it is more like external. In a way, the company has no quote-unquote power. That's where you talk on economy. You talk of economy, you talk of the market itself. For example, last year, when the market crashed in early last year, I made that reference when I was talking about Coca-Cola. Now, it's a crash that happened. It has nothing to do with what the companies are doing. They had no say. They could not prevent coronavirus. But it affected every stock. It affected the market. The market crashed with the pandemic. So these are external factors. The economy, it affects the stock. It affects the stocks. So a company can be doing well fundamentally. Like the fundamental factors can be okay, that they are signing new deals or they are doing well, they are making money and everything. But the external factor is that affecting them. So for the past few months now, the market has been down generally. It has been down. Why? Because we're still in the pandemic world. We're still in a pandemic economy. So while things are moving, the general atmosphere is still down. So this, the pandemic, the economy it has nothing to do with what the company is doing. So if Tesla, like, they should sign 200 million deals, because of the external factor, it will still weigh in on the company. I don't know if you are following. The economy has an effect. Also, you have cases of jobs. So let's say the US economy added more jobs and everything. This thing kind of affects the general market mood. It would also make the market to grow and everything. So you have factors then. You have market analysts. I remember. Market analysts. Now, this is a very tricky situation, market analysts, because these guys, they study a company and they give their remark. They give their analysis that, okay, we see what Tesla has been doing for the past 2 months, 3 months. Okay, we believe this would go up. So you hear something like analyst upgrade. So more like they are anticipating that, okay, Tesla is currently at $680, for example. With what is going on with Tesla, without that, we believe that Tesla share price should be at $750. That's an example. So you believe that. So it now depends on how powerful the analyst is. So if it's an analyst that, yes, everybody, quote unquote, respects, or that they look up to and everything, and they are giving their remark, it can also affect. There are times you see a stock has grown by maybe 10% in a day. And that 10% is because a particular company is giving analysts on this, is upgrading the price of the stock. So there are different kind of, there are some companies that they call investment bankers, like investment banking. I don't know, for those who have heard of JP Morgan, Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Citigroup, all these investment banks, they have kind of analyzed stocks. So that at times you'd hear some scenarios that, okay, an analyst from Goldman Sachs has upgraded Tesla from 650 to 750. So that is the reason why Tesla is up by 6% or 7%. Those kind of situations happen in the stock market. So those are also part of external factors that affect the stock. Another thing you should take note of is sentiment. That is the biggest, but in a way that kind of have big effect in the market. Sentiment, that's where the emotions comes into play. Emotions. So earlier this year, let me digress a bit. Earlier this year, crypto was going up. For Jago that is into crypto, he would understand what I'm saying. So crypto was going up. There was a kind of buzz about cryptocurrency, about Bitcoin. Yes, Bitcoin is going to $100,000. Everybody's buying. Everybody's buying Bitcoin. Everybody's buying. It's going to... What is happening? Sentiment. Everybody just believe that, yes, Bitcoin would go to $100,000. Everybody say, buy Bitcoin now, buy Bitcoin now, buy this now, buy this, that now. Dogecoin is going to the moon. Buy this now, buy. Everybody's talking buy. The price is going up. Because sentiments, emotions is at play. Sentiment, everybody's buying. Now, when the crypto issue happened, I'll just call it issues that will not offend some people. So when the crypto issue happened and the price was now going down, sentiment was at play again. Crypto is already going down. Crypto is crashing. Bitcoin is crashing. Doge is crashing. Everybody, pull out your money. Oh, yeah, run. This one is pulling out their money. This one is selling. Emotions at play. It happens also in the stock market. There's sometimes that a stock is going up. It's just based on sentiment. Everybody just believes that this thing will happen. Let me give perfect. Okay, what drives the price of crypto? First of all, I'm not a crypto person, but I have some basic understanding of crypto. There are different things that drives the price of crypto. But one of the major things which I've seen is sentiment. That I've noticed that sometimes I hear there's some coins that they call shit coins. So let's say this particular coin doesn't really have much value. Doesn't have much, it's not serving any use. Example, Dogecoin. Dogecoin was created more like a joke. So it was just more like the person that created, like, okay, let us create a coin for whether losers or something. Let's just create something and everything. So it had no fundamental value. It was not really serving any purpose or anything. It was not designed for a particular reason. It was not created for a particular reason. It just did it just for play and everything. But earlier this year, when Elon Musk came and was talking, everybody was like, let us buy Doge. So Dogecoin that rose this year, it was not because of any case value or something. It was just emotions, sentiment that was just at play. Elon Musk was just, quote unquote, using people to play. That Dogecoin to the moon, buy Dogecoin. Everybody's just rushing. So one of the major reasons that drives price of crypto majorly is sentiment. There are some good crypto coins, like you have Bitcoin, Ethereum, BNB, and there's one that they call ADA. I'm calling it ADA. So there are some coins that have good case value. Example now, Bitcoin is more like the future of currency. Ethereum is kind of a network that is that's where the likes of NFTs, non-fungible tokens. So those ones are kind of used for creatives. For example, if you buy this shirt, if someone wants to buy this shirt, they may not really know if it is original or fake. They may not really know the original or fake. For example, you're an artist, you have an artwork. That's where you hear the issue of piracy. Somebody is pirating your work. We don't know the original from this fake and everything. But with NFTs and co, it kind of helps you bridge that gap. So you put a product there and everything. They know that this is the original product. Most of us, we hear the Mona Lisa painting. Yeah, okay, yes, this is the original Mona Lisa painting. So any other painting is a counterfeit. So that's the one of the platforms that helps that thing is Ethereum network. So you can see that Bitcoin, Ethereum, and some other good coins, they have case value. They are useful for something. But there are some coins that they are not useful for anything. They are just there rising to the moon and coming back to Earth. Shiba Inu, this one, it is going to be so many coins that they have no case value, but people are just pumping it. They are just, it's just sentiment, excitement. Everybody wants this stock to just pump, to increase by 200%, 3,000%. It's just sentiment. Exactly, pump and dump. Thank you, Jaguar, it's your field, so you know it. Pump and dump. It just like, okay, everybody, let us buy. They buy it, it goes up. Before you know it, everybody said, it's just race, sentiment. So, back to what I was saying, that sentiment affects the price of the stock. So, there was one case that happened earlier this year. So there was a company called CCIV. They were to merge with another company called Lucid. Lucid is a is an electric vehicle company. So that transaction wasn't official yet. But based on the available reports, available analysis, people believe that this transaction is going to happen. I was among those because I did my research and I knew that, yes, CCIV is going to merge with Lucid. There's no other based on the... Okay, Christopher, can we buy stocks with physical dollars in Bamboo? Okay, like I said, for this one, you would have to contact Bamboo because typically the basic way to deposit your money in Bamboo is either you do Naira deposit or you do what's this name? Domiciliary account. So that is the digital, you make a transfer. But if you want to deposit with physical dollars, remember, I for those who joined me at the beginning, like I said, that when you are trying to make your deposit in Bamboo, it has a kind of one-time account number. So you they'll generate an account number for you to make a deposit. After you make a deposit, you want to make another deposit, maybe a few days later, it's not be that same account number. Just like the way OTP works. You want to buy, pay for something online and your bank generates OTP. Once you've already used that OTP, you cannot use it again for another transaction, they'll generate. So sometimes, so if you want to deposit with physical dollars, you would reach out to Bamboo. Let me type their email. Support at investbamboo.com. So that's their email. So you send them email that, okay, you have physical dollars, you want to make a deposit, then they will now, I've not used physical dollars to deposit before because I don't know, I've not used before, so I can't really tell you how it would work. But reach out to them, they would let you know either they would generate an account number for you to now deposit at Wema Bank, because Wema Bank that they use. So maybe you deposit at Wema Bank, then you will now send proof of payment to them. I don't know how that works because it's digital in Nigeria. So reach out to them and explain, so they will tell you if it is possible or what to do, but sharp picture and everything. I hope you understand, Christopher. How can we control emotions? That's what I'm going to talk about next, because I'm heading into the sentiment part. So that's what I would talk about next. How do you handle emotions when you're investing in stock markets? One thing, the first thing to note of is, why are you in the market? Why are you in the market? That is the first thing you really need to understand, because you really need to focus. Now, for those who have read my book, I would make this analysis. So I usually kind of use relationship or women to analyze, to explain stock markets, because it's kind of easy to understand. You know, once we hear relationship, dating and everything, everybody's mind, we can easily understand. So for example, if as a guy now, you have a girlfriend, she's your girlfriend and everything. So ladies will bear me witness. They may be deceiving you that, yes, you are the most beautiful girl in the world. There's no girl that's the most beautiful girl in the world. Because no matter how beautiful a girl is, you will still see another girl that is more beautiful than that girl. That is just the truth. No matter how hot, beautiful, sexy, you will just go out one day, you will see one girl like, where has this girl been in all this world? So, for example, you have a girlfriend. Because you have a girlfriend doesn't mean every girl that you see, you would either sleep with the girl or you can't taste the girl and everything. You'll be messing yourself up. So, you have a girlfriend, be in that relationship. Except if there is crisis. Now, this is how the stock market works. For example, we have domestic violence and everything. So you're in a relationship with a guy. Occasionally, the guy usually slap you. That is a warning. Occasionally, he usually insult you, call you names, that you're an idiot, you're a fool, and this. That is a warning. Is there a warning that this relationship may be heading nowhere? So for the wise ones, they'll be like, guy, stop. I don't like this. They say, okay, baby, sorry. I would repent. I will not do it again. 2 weeks later, he slaps you again. He beats you and everything. You will go to work. You will put makeup and everything. They'll say, what happened? I fell down from the stairs. Meanwhile, your boyfriend is beating you. That is a sign that this relationship, it is not working. So if the lady is smart, she would get out of that relationship before it becomes too violent. The guy is just slapping you. Yeah, see, enjoying and everything. He's calling you names. Is it until when he now use stick and start beating you before you will now leave? So he's slapping you, doing all those things. You're warning him, he's not answering. You leave that relationship. That's the same thing with the stock market. You buy a stock and you're hearing that the management is doing rubbish. They are losing revenue every time. They are losing revenue. They are not having good partnership and everything. That is a sign that this company may not be heading in the right direction. So you don't need to wait until the stock now goes down to zero before you pull out your money. You see signs, patterns that this company is falling. This company is not doing well. Pull out your money, sell, either at a profit or at a loss. Reserve some money that this is not working. I'm out. It's not until when the company is now going down, that there is zero. You know, that you hear case of, I lost my money in the stock market. Let me give an example, BlackBerry. So 10 years ago, you agree with me that BlackBerry was like the king of smartphones and everything. BlackBerry and Nokia, they were like, everyone wanted to buy both 5, both 10 and everything. They were the king of smartphones and everything. But then, okay, around that time, BlackBerry share price was around $97, $95. And in 2008, it was really, really up. But then the market began to change. The smartphone market began to change from BlackBerry and Nokia to Android and iPhone. So the market dynamics was already changing. So for an investor, if maybe you had shares in BlackBerry, maybe you bought at 80, that's risen to 90, you can see that the smartphone market is already changing. iPhone is already coming, is already gaining ground. Android is already gaining ground. The guy is already slapping you, is already abusing you, abusing your mother, abusing your father. You already see the signs that this is not working. Pull out your money. Now, for the BlackBerry example that I gave, everything was already changing. The market was moving away from BlackBerry and Nokia. So for someone that had those shares, if they were not observing, they'll be losing ground. They're saying that BlackBerry is already losing market share and everything. Let me pull out my money. He's just stopping me. Let me leave this relationship. He's just pushing me. He's abusing me. Let me leave this relationship. Now, that is one part. Now, there are some people that already changed already. They still have their shares in BlackBerry. Now, BlackBerry is about $8 or $10. The reason why it's fell that much is because they've lost market share in the business. Like I said, in the stock market, you are investing in business, you're investing in companies. And dynamics changes. At times, a particular thing that is making rain in the market will not be what is happening now. Then it was BlackBerry and Co. Now it is Android, iPhone. BlackBerry is not in the market. That I will notice at a point during the last when one BlackBerry 10 or Q10 came, it had Android device. For those who use BlackBerry, the time BlackBerry was kind of using Android software and everything. So they were trying to enter a losing market. It didn't work out. Now BlackBerry has already transitioned from a phone manufacturing company. They are now into softwares and cybersecurity. As a matter of fact, in the electric vehicle, most of the EVs operating now, they are making use of BlackBerry software. So it's kind of they are changing the company again. They are starting a new phase of the company. So that is another thing to look out for. Once the market is already changing and everything, you make observing, then you can decide to pull out your money and everything. So like I was saying about how to control your emotions when you are trading stocks or investing in stocks. There are sometimes in the market that you have a stock and you just see that another stock has risen 200%. There's nothing you can do about it. It has increased, it has increased. So I have a strategy. Which approach do you want to use to invest in? You want to invest for the long term? Fine. There are different sectors of the economy. There are different company sectors. You believe in the electric vehicle industry. Fine. Invest in EVs. you invest in it doesn't mean another stock will not go up. There's one time that you have your stock, maybe you have 10% profits, at times 20% loss, at times maybe 70% profit. There's one time that you see another stock that you don't have, it has increased by 700% just to it. Just shut your mind off it. You don't have that stock, you don't have that stock. It has become. You have a stock doesn't mean you should pursue every stock that is increasing. So people you see that this stock has already increased 40%, let me go and buy. You see that this stock has already increased 60%, let me go and buy. No, maintain your focus. That's why I gave the example of the dating relationship. You have a girlfriend, she's beautiful and everything. Be with that girlfriend. You have seen five other girls that have, it doesn't mean you should go and meet them. You may be more beautiful than your girlfriend. It doesn't mean you should go and meet them. Except if the relationship that you are in is not favorable again, is not loving you the way he used to love you. She's not adoring you the way she used to adore you. Then you cannot decide that, babe, this is not working. Let us end it. So with that, you are controlling your emotions. You are not just breaking with her. You are not just breaking up with her because maybe she just did only two things. You've analyzed everything and you've seen that this relationship is not heading in the right direction. You don't allow your emotions to enter because there are some girls that, yes, they've seen that this guy is beating them. This guy is harassing them. And you see, they are not happy in the relationship, but they are still staying there. Why? Because he loves me. Because he gives me money. Your emotions is at play. You are not controlling your emotions because clearly things are not okay. Why not leave? You are given one flip excuse or something. It also affects, takes place in the stock market. Things are not okay with the company. Leave. You remove your money, but I still like the company. This is that. You'll be losing your money. Another thing to take note of when you are controlling your emotions, because like I said, the stock market doesn't move on a straight line. There's sometimes that the stock would go down depending on the factors. I'd given example of fundamental factors, technical factors, the economy can affect it. Sometimes that the economy will not be good, it affects the stock market. What do you do? Except if there's something wrong, there's a particular phrase I usually use that. Until the fundamentals has changed, do not sell the stock. So everything is going on fine, but the stock is down. It could be technical factors that is at play. There's sometimes that a particular company is doing well and everything, but the technical factor that's at play. A stock is down doesn't mean you are wrong. So that is another thing to take note of when you are controlling your emotions. A stock is down doesn't mean you are wrong. And a stock is up doesn't mean you are right. Which takes me back to the pump and dump that we discussed about with crypto coins and everything. A stock is going up doesn't mean everything is okay. It could be I don't use the word scam, but it's like a pump and dump. There's no fundamental reason to back up the growth of that stock. There's nothing fundamental. There's nothing happening inside that's making the price to go up. Because there's nothing that is making the price go up, as it's going up, it will surely fall down. Because there's nothing backing it up. It's not that the company has signed a big deal or the company is generating more revenue than expected or they're bringing in big people into the management. Nothing is there just on our own and the stock is just going up. What is making that thing to go up, it will surely fall down back because there's no fundamental reason that's backing up that growth. So if everything is okay with the company, but it is down. You don't need to sell because it is going down. So that's why research comes into play, to know why you are buying this stock. When you know why you've bought this stock, you will not really be disturbed even if the price is going down. So that's another thing to do to control emotions. You ask yourself, why is this company going down? Why is the stock down? You can also look at the overall market. If the overall market is down and your stock is down, you don't need to bother yourself. Because the overall market is saying that things are not okay. you're not disturbing yourself that things are not working. No, you don't need to disturb yourself, because overall everything is not working. So even if you are not working, I'm not the brother. But if overall everything is okay, we're in a bullish market, stocks are going up and your stock is going down, you say, oh God, what did happen? Everybody's making money, you are not making money. Kilo share, what happened? Your mates are making money, they are not making money. What is happening? What is happening? So there's one time that, like I said, the bullish markets. So for the sake of those who don't really so in the stock market, they use animals to depict investment strategies. For those who have read my book, I talk about the animals of Wall Street, so you kind of understand. So there is a bull. So when you hear bull or bullish market and everything, it's an optimism behavior. So you are optimistic that the price would go up. You are bullish on a stock. So when I say Wale is bullish on Tesla, it shows that he's optimistic that Tesla would go up. Then there's the bear. So you hear bearish market, things are not going well, the price is going down. So when you are bearish, or when you are bearish on a particular stock, you are expecting that the stock would go down. You are pessimistic. You are pessimistic in the drop of the stock. So if in a bullish, and that is another way to know if the stock that you have is good. Like now, like I said, for the past few months, I'm still explaining how to control your emotions. So in the past few months, the market has been down. So your stocks may be down. It is down doesn't mean you should sell, because everywhere is down. So you need to control your emotion that, okay, everywhere is down, I don't need to disturb myself. Now, when the bullish market comes, everywhere, everything is going up. Then if everywhere is going up and the stock that you have is not going up, is this kind of sign that maybe you have the wrong stock or this company is not doing well? Because all factors indicate that this should be up. The market is bullish and everything, but your stock is down. Oga, why are you down? So that's another way to control your emotions. Why is this stock going down? Is there anything fundamental that is making the stock go down? If there's nothing fundamental that is making it going down, it's likely a technical factor, unseen factor, maybe the economy or something. So you keep calm. Don't really need to disturb yourself and everything. That is if you are investing. But if you are trading, I would come back to trading in a bit. Let me answer this next question. What if there's a sentiment at play on a particular stock to pump up, but suddenly pumps down? What is the cost of it? Okay, if I get your question well, you are saying that there's a sentiment that this stock is supposed to go up, but suddenly it goes down. What is the cost of this? Now, another thing to know is that in the market, you have institutions and you have retail investors. That thing you should need to focus on. They are the big players in the industry, in the market. So these big players, they are called whales. Remember I told you that they use animals to depict things in the stock market. And in the ocean, whale is like the biggest fish and everything. So they can swallow everything. They are the big guys, they control things, they move things. They can dictate the flow of the market. They have millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars to put in the stock. So when they put in the stock, it affects the market. So you can do your analysis and you say that, yes, this stock is supposed to go down, but the big guys are going the other way. It can also affect. So this question is not really, not like it's not straightforward, but there are some other questions that needs to be asked, because there are some other factors. It depends on the stock, depends on the sector of the stock. So you look at the stock, you look at the sector, then you look at the stock, the sector, then how big is that stock in that sector? Because in every sector, you have the big guys and you have the small guys. You have the leaders of the industry and you have the, I don't use all the wannabes, but the small guys. So there are so many things you need to consider. to know why a stock is to pump up or not. So there are some other questions that needs to be asked in this question to know which direction to go to. Are you guys following? You are following, let me see your comments. Okay, good. So I'm now continuing with this. You also need to now there's something that they call. Do I have a message? Okay, good, thank you. There's something that they call dollar cost averaging. Christopher, you are not following. Please, what is your question? Like I said, if I have any question, let me know. Let me unmute Christopher. Hello, Christopher.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon. Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, I was trying to show your network bar. Network bar on my screen is showing just one. I don't know if it's just me. I have to leave my house to come to a fiber link so I can meet up with you. But without cracking or I have to check your own network. Network here steady. I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's just me. I don't care.
I don't know. Maybe it will just you because okay. This meeting is actually recorded one. And so my network bar is full on both my phone and the laptop. So I don't know what is everyone can everyone hear me? I don't know, maybe it is you, Christopher. Because everyone is hearing me, so maybe it's from your end. Because if everyone is hearing me and
earlier on when I joined, I heard some other person talking. I could hear them clearly, but when you are talking, it's breaking up at my end.
Okay, this is what you do. Maybe you log out, you leave the meeting room and join in again. Let's see if that would work. Because everyone can clearly hear me.
I've done that like 4 or 5 times.
Wow. I don't really know why. It's like that, but from all indications, it's from your end.
I try to unmute some other person. When they talk, I hear clearly. But when you are talking, I just noticed it's breaking.
I don't know. Maybe it's from your end because everyone, even if you can check the comment section, everyone can clearly hear me. So maybe it's from your end. But just try again. Let's see if it works. But it's likely that it's from your end. But the meeting is recorded, so if there's anything, you'd get the recording. And even if you watch it and you have some questions, you can ask me. I'm available. So let's see how it goes. So let me mute. Okay, so what was I saying again? Okay, yes, I remember. So I was talking about dollar cost averaging. So when you are investing, like I said, that the more money you have, the better your profits. At the beginning, I gave an example of I invest $100 and another person invests $20 and we both bought the same stock with the same percentage. I would make more money than him because I put in more money. So one thing you should also note is that you need to increase the units of stock that you have. You need to increase it. So you buy a stock, maybe you bought it for $20, you keep adding more money. You keep adding more because the more you have, the better your profits. So for example, you put in $20 today, maybe you have some other extra cash you put in regularly. Now, this is irrespective of the nature of the economy or the market rather. So whether the market is up or the market is down, you keep increasing your positions. You keep increasing your positions. This is where personal finance comes into play. Personal finance. At the beginning, I talked about job and everything because it is an income. You need the income to determine to invest. If there's no income, what are you investing? So you need to sort out the income issue or the income discussion. Once there's a predictable source of income, you know how much you are expecting, whether in a week or in a month or whatever. Maybe you did an analysis and everything. Okay, every month in total, I make about maybe 200K or 300K, whether for my job or for my side gig or something. I sell some products, I sell on this and that. You decide, okay, every month I'm making about 200K. I can decide to be investing maybe 50K, 100K, depending on you and everything. This is not really a personal finance class and everything, but let's just pick an example. Say that, okay, I can be investing 80K every month in the stock market. So today, you deposit 80K. 80K now is about 100K is $200. So 80K would be maybe $180 or $170, something within that nature. So every month, you are depositing $150 in the stock market and everything. So you keep increasing your position in the stock. Maybe you started out with $20. You don't need to remain there. You start out with $20, you don't need to remain there. Because how much money you would make depends on how much money you have. It is a principle. Garbage in, garbage out. It's what you put in that you determine what you get. You cannot cheat nature. You cannot cheat principles. If I have $1,000 in a stock, and Chris and Emmanuel has just $50 in the stock. Except if we buy the same stock, there's no magic that will happen. I bought Tesla, Emmanuel bought Tesla, I put in $1,000, Emmanuel put in $100. There's no magic on that sun, on that heaven or hell that will make Emmanuel make more money than me. It's not possible. No matter the juju that it does, they cannot make more money than me. Because we bought the same stock. I have more money in that stock than him. So that's another thing you should take note of. You need to be putting in more money inside your portfolio. See it as an asset. Because you're actually building an asset. Your money is working for you. For example, this week, during Ilaya, during the Muslim holiday, there was no work. My portfolio, one of my stock, gave me 20% that day. It increased by 20%. So while everybody's on holiday, my money is working for me. That's it. So you need to put more money in your portfolio. How much you put, I can't tell you that. It depends on you. If you can be putting in 500,000 naira in your portfolio every month, better for you. If it is 50,000 naira, you can be putting every month, better for you. If it is 2 million naira, it's all yours. It's your decision to make. Because the more money you make depends on how much you put. And which leads me to this other point, that time in the market is better than time in the market. I will explain. Time in the market is better than timing the market. So the more time you spend in the market, it will yield you more than you trying to predict, you trying to time the market and everything. And that is the issue I have with trading. It's not that trading is wrong. Like I said, there are two sides of the coin. You either trade or you invest. If you read my book, I made mention of Guardiola and Mourinho. These two are two of the most successful managers, football managers of all time. They have two different approach. The approach Guardiola is using is not the same approach Mourinho is using. But both of them are successful. They won trophies and everything. Their approach is different, but they are winners. Because, okay, we have some ladies here. So I don't know if you watch football, but let's just give an example, whether you watch football or not. No matter how well you play a match, It is the 3 points that matters at the end of the day. It is for you to win. So even like wipe 20 shots, you are dribbling everybody, you dribble the whole world and everything. If you don't win the match, your dribbling is of no use. So even like dribble everybody, and may I not dribble, and I score, and I win. It's the 3 points that matters. Because at the end of the day, nobody would remember who dribbles or not. For example, now, this last football season now, apologies to those who don't watch football, but I'll make it as basic as example. This last football season now, in the Champions League in Europe, Chelsea won. Chelsea won by 1-0. Nobody's really concerned about who got more ball than the other. Nobody's really concerned about who had more shots than the other. Nobody's really concerned about who dribbled or who. The main thing is that Chelsea's name is on the trophy. Chelsea won the Champions League. However they won, it doesn't concern anybody. Whether it was own goal, whether it was free kick, whether it was penalty, whether it was dribbling, it doesn't really concern anybody. The main thing is that Chelsea has won and they lifted the trophy. It's the same thing in the stock market. The main thing is for you to make your money. Because at the end of the day, that's what matters. You secure the bag, you make your money. That's what is important. So if you like trade, if you like invest, the main thing is that you are making your profits, you are making your money. But with trading, you are trying to predict that the price of a stock would increase at this stage and everything. Let me share my screen again. I just hope this will not mess me up. I want to show you guys something concerning the trading, and I just hope this will not mess me up. But we go anyway. We move. So I'm trying to share my screen again. So I want to show you something. I hope you guys can see this. Okay, still loading. So let's see how to. Let me check it on my phone. Okay. It's trying to share. Let's wait for it to load. Okay. Mr. Wally, I would allow you in. Let this load first. Okay. Benedict, I'm seeing your question. The recent rally on AMC stock has really left me confused as what one should consider when making a good pick. Is there a rule of thumb for picking a good stock? I'll come to that question. But first, let me explain what I'm to explain by sharing my screen. I'll come to that question, Benedict. So, I don't have in the waiting room. Let me admit him. Why is this simple thing now? I'm coming. So I'm going to be waiting. While I'm coming out. Okay, yeah, the screen is up. Thank you. So let me show you guys something that has to do with trading. Finance. I want to show you guys something. let's this thing load first. So I want to actually explain the issue of time the market and trading so that you guys will understand what that is. So I'm going to show some charts. The screen is up. Thank you, Gachima. Screen is up. So let this thing just load. Once it loads, I'll explain what I'm to explain. Let me stop it so as not to waste our time. Don't I think I'll stop the sharing. Let me stop the sharing because it's slowing me down. I'll still explain it regardless. Let's see. Yeah, stop sharing. So let me continue. When you are trying to time the market, because that's one thing with trading, you are focused on the price movement. And when you focus on the price movement, you have to analyze the charts very well. You saw those candlesticks, those green and red stuff that you are seeing. That's what traders use. Because when you are trading, you would consider entry points and exit points. It is very, very important for a trader, the entry points. Because if you enter at a very good price and you exit at the higher price, you make some decent profits. Now, how do you analyze that this stock would either get to this price or to increase? That is when it comes to technical analysis, you are analyzing the charts. Okay, I think it was the last online class I had. The guy was like, the reason is not, he has not started investing is because he doesn't know how to analyze charts. And you don't need to analyze charts before you invest. It's not compulsory to analyze charts. Let me move this thing. So, I'm coming. I don't know why it's coming up with this. Okay, so as I was saying, you don't need to analyze, you don't need to understand technical analysis before you invest in the stock market. You can invest without. So this is the difference. For technical analysis, that's where the issue of stop loss and take profits comes into play. Let me explain. So with stop loss and take profits, for example, you buy a stock, you are trying to trade the stock because of price action that I believe, okay, to increase by this certain stage and everything. So you are now putting a stop loss is a kind of protection. That's to explain what someone made a comment. Let me see if I can get it. That if you analyze everything and it's supposed to go up and it doesn't go up, what will you do? Let me see if I can get it. I got it. So what if there's a sentiment at play on a particular stock to pump, but suddenly pumps down? What is so? For example, if you analyze a stock, you are trying to trade a stock. So you're analyzing that, okay, to get a particular stage. So my basic example, let's say the stock is $10 and you bought at $10. You're analyzing that it should get to maybe 15 or 18, then you decide to sell. Now, when you want to put in your stop loss is a kind of protection that's, okay, if things don't go as planned and it is coming down, once it gets to this price, let me sell. So it's a kind of automatic something. So for example, you bought the stock at $10 and you're analyzing that, okay, to get to 15 or 20. You now decide that, okay, if what I'm expecting doesn't happen and it decides to go down, once it gets to $8, that the app should sell it for you. So it's more like an automatic sort that once it gets to $8, it will just trigger it has sold. So yeah, you're trying to kind of limit your losses. Now with take profit is also the positive gauge. So you're analyzing that it would get to $18. And you don't know whether it will go up, because at times a stock has gone up, it will still go up again. But you're not really sure if it will go up and everything. But you said that, okay, whatever happens, once it gets to 18, I am okay. So even if it goes beyond that, once it just gets to 18, I'm okay. I can decide to sell. So you put your take profit benchmark there. So the stock is going up. You bought at 10, it's 15, it's getting to 17. It already reached your trigger point, 18. It would automatically sell. So even if it goes beyond that to 2025, you've already put your benchmark at 18. So once it reaches that 18, it's going to trigger off and to sell. So these are the things traders use to trade, because in a way, you cannot be 100% sure in the market. There's nothing that is 100% certain. Life is not certain itself. There are people that they wake up and they don't see the next day. So life is not certain. Everything is not certain, but with your you can, there's something that they call mitigate risk. So knowledge helps you to mitigate risk. So when you know what you are doing, yes, it's not 100% certain, but when you know what you are doing, you can get better results. Going back to my relationship example, a guy asks you out as a lady, and you decide that, okay, I love him, he's good. I accept, you guys are dating. If you are dating, there's no assurance that you will marry. Even if you are married, there's no assurance that your marriage would grow 30 years or something. Yes, everybody prays to live long and for their marriage to grow, but there's no certainty that it would happen. There's no certainty that after 5 years, you guys will not divorce or something. But knowledge helps you to know that me and my partner, me and my husband or my wife, we are moving in the right direction. We understand each other. We know our love language. I know what she likes and I do it for her. She knows what I like and she does this for me. I know what pisses her off, so I don't do it. She knows what pisses me off, so she doesn't do it. That is knowledge. Now, there's no certainty that you guys would last 30 years, but with your knowledge, you are able to put things together. Not necessarily patch it up, but you already know how to relate with each other. So with that, your marriage will be going, and you spend 5 years, 10 years, anniversary, and everything. It's the same thing with the stock market. There's no certainty. Nothing is 100% certain. But with your analysis, with everything, you know that, okay, this company is doing well, this company should do well. There's not 100% certain. But with whatever you are seeing, it's expected that this company is supposed to go well. And when it goes well and everything, you are good to go. So that is, before I continue, does anyone have any question? Or any, yeah, let's discuss. Let me unmute everyone before I go to the next thing I want to discuss. Let's talk. So you can unmute. Christopher, do you have anything to tell us?
I can hear you.
Okay. Do you have any questions?
I have a question.
Okay.
Yes, I do. We talked about bamboo.
Yes.
A friend of mine came from South America a year ago, and he told me about Sheraton. He bought the Tesla stock and made huge profits from it. But then he was telling me, but there was no basic guidance on, okay, this is how you start, this is how you fund your account. Then what I told him, I wanted to fund my account using dollar because I don't want to be paid in naira. So then I think for him it could do it because he did open his account and went for study. When he got back, I noticed he couldn't fund with his dollar account. He had some restrictions over here. So what he does is he would call his friends over there. Maybe they did business, his money they will pay to his account over there, then he funds. When I opened the Shaka account and I paid money to my domiciliary account, I noticed when I wanted to move money, there are restrictions in banks, say if I'm probably, I think, minimum of $10,000 as a corporate organization, individuals, you have to get MasterCard. Because of the plenty requirement, I just know. So the guy who recommended me, who sent me your the content you had online, he was telling me about Bamboo. And he said I should just register and attend your class. I told him okay. So the day I registered, and I told him that okay, I have some dollars. I think I have some in the house and I have some in the bank. So he was not like, wait, this is what he explained to me before I even downloaded Bamboo, that on Bamboo, you will even have accounts, like a domiciliary dollar account, I can go and pay dollar into. Because what I needed was, I needed my profit in dollar and also paid to my domiciliary account. That was my main thing for paying interest to talk. It was not like, okay, to be done in Bamboo. After registering, I told him that okay, I'm going to go home and get some dollars. When we got to the option for dollar deposit or wiring, it was showing error. It was showing error. So I spoke to him. He told me that okay, I can write support. After I wrote support, support telling me that if it's my first time, I can't do that. So I now ask support. What do you mean if it's my first time I can't deposit the dollar? They said I can't deposit the dollar. And I said, okay, so when can I deposit the dollar? In such a way that when I make profit in dollar, I get paid in dollar. Okay. That was the last response I had from them. He finally sent me your link and I joined. So one of the reasons I am here is first of all, I've downloaded Bamboo, I've registered, I'm having funding. And one of the things support says mentioned was you can only fund from your account. It has to carry your name.
Okay.
Yes. So please, how can you help me sort this out?
Okay. Thank you. So let me start with this. First of all, I've not deposited money in dollars before. All the money I've been depositing is in Naira. So I deposit for my account and everything. So I've not used the missionary account to fund Bamboo. And as at now, I don't know of anyone that I've used the missionary, because most of the people, most of my friends, most people that use Bamboo are Nigerians. So they deposit from their bank accounts and everything. So if you have a domiciliary account and everything, you would have to discuss with Bamboo, because like I said, I've not deposited with domiciliary. So I'd even have done it with domiciliary account. Okay, say this is how it works and everything. I've not deposited with domiciliary. So I can't really tell you that this is how it works. Now, it doesn't mean Bamboo, because the option is there. So definitely they would be accepting domiciliary. So for whatever reason, I don't know. Maybe it's their network or something. I don't really know. But yeah, raising up your hand, Christopher.
Okay. Yes. Okay, now I get your point that as it is now, you're not so sure about how you get to deposit of the salary. But if I can deposit in Naira and get paid in dollar.
Okay, you want to be paid in dollar. So, okay,
yes.
Okay, you want to withdraw your money in dollar and not in Naira.
Yes.
Okay, so now this is same and that, because let's understand this something, guys. Bamboo is a Nigerian platform. So, Robbie, there's an app called Robinhood, there's Webull. Those ones are foreign. They don't give access to Africans or Nigerians. So we don't have access to those ones. So if, example, if you're using Robinhood, you can deposit in dollars and obviously withdraw in dollars because it's a foreign symbol. But with Bamboo, which is Nigeria, I've not withdrawn money in dollars, because If you want to withdraw money, the account that is my normal bank account. So I'm withdrawing my money in Naira. So withdrawing in dollars, I don't really know how, because I've not done it and I've not had any reason to withdraw my money in dollars. Because also I don't have a domicile account that I use to fund Bamboo. So I use my normal Naira bank account to fund, and if I need to withdraw my money, I withdraw it back to that account. So maybe you would have to discuss with Bamboo again. And if I thought Bamboo is giving you, maybe he has not stayed comfortable. You have address abroad. So maybe you know someone that is either in America or something. You can open a Robinhood account, either Robinhood or people. If you have maybe people there, you can use their address, their social security number or something, just their details to register. Then you can easily transact with dollars, you deposit in dollars, withdraw in dollars. But if you have to with Nigeria, either Bamboo, Chaka or Truth, in a way you will still have to either withdraw your money in Naira or deposit in Naira. I don't really know. So that one is has to do with Bamboo. So I think you have to discuss with them and know which one would work for you. I don't know if you are clear now.
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
And please, lastly.
Exactly. Thank you. Sorry. Sorry, Christopher. So Wale even said something which is perfect. He said they will not allow you pay in Naira and withdraw in dollars. Yes, perfectly. Thank you. Because example now, one of the ways Bamboo also make money is through Forex, like the foreign exchange. So whereby you deposit in, so if the exchange rate currently is 510 Naira to a dollar. So you deposit with 510 and you withdraw with five hundred. So they make 10 Naira profits on the foreign. So if you deposit in Naira and you want to withdraw in dollars, Bamboo will be losing. So it doesn't work that way. So you can't deposit in Naira and withdraw in dollars, because dollar is obviously higher than Naira. So you they will be losing that way. For those who have downloaded Bamboo, check it very well. In the deposit, you see that the deposit and the withdrawal exchange rate, there's 10 Naira difference. So I think the current exchange rate is on Bamboo is 510. So if I deposit with 510. So if I withdraw, you are withdrawing 500. So they would make 10 Naira profit margin. That's another way they make their money. So that's, I don't know if you understand now.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So okay. The is recorded already. So if, because I noticed that some were having issues with their connection joining in and same. So it is recorded. You recorded the it will be made available to everyone. That is not an issue. It will be made available to anyone. So does anyone have any other question before I continue? And before we talk about how to analyze stock and the sectors to invest in, that's what I'll talk about next. Does anyone have any question for now? Or should I go ahead? If I can go ahead, just send it in the chat room that I can go ahead. Can I go ahead, guys? Okay, good. Go ahead. So let's now talk about the sectors to look out for in the economy. So if you've read the Stock Market Millionaire, I analyzed some sectors and the reason why. So I'm going to talk about it now. So another way to know which stock to invest in, because there are thousands of stocks in the stock market. So in a way, you cannot analyze, it's not possible to analyze everything. So which one would you now go for? I made mention of, at the beginning, your risk tolerance and your age bracket. Now, we talk about the sectors of the economy. The sectors that you should invest in is the one that has future growth. Because you're investing for the future. So you cannot be investing in something that is already behind. You cannot be investing in a company that their business model has been is already phasing out. Now, perfectly, the COVID has kind of shifted everything in the world. So how the world operates has been shifted a bit. Even in the workplace, the work dynamics is now a bit different. You now hear of remote work. People are working from home, working from anywhere in the world and everything. That is affecting things. So the sectors you should invest in is one, a sector that has future growth. The one that has future growth. And one of the ways you know the sector that has future growth is the sectors that profited from the COVID situation. Now, during the pandemic, there were some sectors of the industry that were affected, and there were some sectors that were benefiting from it. Now, the sectors that were affected doesn't mean they are phasing out. For example, the travel industry was affected because with COVID, people could not move about. So, tourism was affected, people could not travel. Airlines were grounded, people could not travel. Hotels were on like lockdown, people could not lodge and everything. These three sectors were affected. They are affected, they are being affected doesn't mean they don't have future growth. Because until the world dies, let me use that phrase, until the world dies, people will still be traveling. Aeroplanes will still be operating because people still need to move from one place to another. So you already know that in a way, transportation is a huge sector to invest in. Transportation, because people, no matter, even when the whole COVID thing is has ended, in fact, we are not as true with the COVID economy, but people are still traveling. But there are just regulations, use your nose mask, social distancing and everything. You do your testing, vaccine, but travel is still operating. People will still move from one place to another. No matter what happens, tourism will still be a huge factor because people will still need to visit too many places. There are people now traveling to Maldives. You want to go to Dubai. Dubai has tourism and everything. You want to travel to this country for tourism. You want to enjoy the... So tourism will still be a huge factor. Though it was affected by COVID, but it cannot phase out. So the modalities may now change. That is one. During COVID, because people were on lockdown and everything, they needed to be entertained. They needed to be entertained. So the gaming sector, gaming has been a huge factor. But during the pandemic, it's now gained more relevance because people were at home, so they needed to keep themselves engaged. They needed to keep themselves busy. That's why the likes of Netflix was up because people could not go to the cinema to watch films anymore because of social distance and they could not go to, but they needed to watch films. So Netflix was available for them. So they could binge a movie on their smartphone. So there was more demand. Remember earlier I talked about demand and supply. There was more demand for this kind of company. So Netflix was going up. There was more demand for their services. The airlines were going down because there was no demand for their services. People were not traveling. People were not booking tickets. So definitely the share price was going down. So that's another sector to take note of, the entertainment industry. You also have gaming. You have cloud computing, cloud storage. Because of how things are now virtual, they will need to be storing information in the cloud. I believe everyone here knows about cloud, so I don't really need to explain what cloud is. We know about cloud storage. You are storing your files in Google Drive, in cloud storage and everything. So companies, that sector is going to be huge going forward. Cloud computing, people need to store things in the cloud. Because when you store something in the cloud, you can easily access the information anywhere in the world. So for example, all the contacts on your phone, you save it to the cloud, whether Google Drive, like me, I save my own on Samsung cloud because I use Samsung. So I save it on Samsung cloud and everything. So if anything happens to my phone, whether it gets missing or stolen or something, my information there is not wiped off. All I need to do is to get a new Samsung phone. And I log in my details and have access to all my information. So that is another thing, cloud storage, cloud computing. it would be a huge factor going forward, because people start storing things in the cloud and everything. So that's another sector. Also, electric vehicles. I'm a huge fan of electric vehicles. Electric vehicles is another sector, because you cannot do without transportation. You cannot do without mobility. The world cannot do without mobility. People will surely move from one place to another. People will surely buy cars. They will surely need to move and everything. So electric vehicles is important. Why? Because there's the whole global warming, moving away from from oil and gas to renewable energy and everything. So that's another sector. You have gaming, you have AI, artificial intelligence is going to be huge. AI, although AI is still a broad, there are still segments under artificial intelligence. Because under artificial intelligence, you have to do it robotics, drones, sensors, so many things. You also think of software. You think of, okay, there's this sector, there's this branch under health. There's telehealth. So telehealth is more like fintech. Fintech is using technology for finance. So telehealth is more like using technology for health. It's more like the future of the health sector. Because with the pandemic and everything, it is now, it will get to a stage whereby you don't really need to see a doctor. Or there are some cases that you need physical appearance of the doctor. And maybe you want to do maybe surgery or transplant or all those things. It cannot be done virtually. You have to see a doctor, they will operate you and everything. But there are some cases that can be done virtually. You consult with a doctor, you don't need to travel to America or Dubai. You can communicate with a doctor, he gives you a prescription, he tells you what to do. How many of us have watched Money Heist? In Money Heist season 4, towards the ending, when Nairobi was shot, that Rio was kind of doing operation on Nairobi. So they did a connection and they were communicating with a doctor. Because, perfect example, they were inside the bank. They could not leave, because if they leave, the police will arrest them. And Nairobi was already shot, so they needed to rescue and everything. They had some tools, and so Rio did a connection, like they were consulting with a doctor. So the doctor was now giving them prescription that, okay, cut this thing, do this. For those who watch that scene, you know what I'm talking about, the Money Heist. So that is an example of what telehealth can do using technology in the health sector. That is one of the things to invest in, one of the sectors to take note of. Are you guys following? I want to be sure that my connection is okay. Can you guys hear me? Are you guys with me? Let me see. Okay, yes. Thank you. So, another thing to take note of is the learning sector, e-learning. No, with the pandemic and everything, because the pandemic kind of did a drastic change to everything. So you need to focus on that. Not like focus, but use that as a guide to know what is, because that is perfect example. You know, I gave example of the BlackBerry situation, BlackBerry and Nokia, that the market was already shifting. It was not a drastic change that pandemic just came and when I'm using BlackBerry and using iPhone. No. So the slow and gradual, things were already moving away from them. The dynamics was already changing. COVID has brought a kind of dynamics to everything. Things have already changed. So, for example, in the education sector, before you would have to rather go to the four walls of a university, you rather travel before you get a degree, you come to class, teacher will teach and everything. But even before COVID, there was already virtual learning, but COVID just made it big and everything, in the sense that you can gain admission to Rome Business School even without going to Rome. There's a virtual edition. You pay your money, you meet with a professor. There are short courses. You have the likes of Fiverr. Okay, no, this one is for freelancing. Fiverr and Upwork is for freelancing. So people could get jobs online and everything. For the education part, you have Coursera, Udemy, and the likes. You can get courses there to learn. So you can even get admission to Harvard Business School, the virtual session, you meet with a professor, either they do meeting or something. Okay, yes, if your battery is used, no problem. If your battery is down, no problem. So as I was saying, for the Harvard Business School, you do that. So e-learning is another sector because the COVID something has already made the education sector different. So you also have logistics, you have, like I said, transportation, you have e-commerce, fintech. So these are the companies, these are the sectors to look out for. Now, when you now check this sector that, okay, which one am I comfortable with? Because you don't need to buy everything. Even if this sector is good, you might not necessarily need to buy. It's not compulsory. So you look for the one that you easily understand. That's that. If you don't understand, because you invest only in what you understand. If you don't understand a sector, you can't really understand how they make that money. You cannot understand how the business would grow. Because like I said at the beginning, all companies are there to make money. So if you don't understand the business model, how will you be able to control your emotions when the stock is down? How will you be able to analyze when you don't understand everything? How will you be able to come? At a point many years ago, Amazon has dropped by 70% at one time. It was down by 70%. But now look at where Amazon is today. Every company has gone down at one point or the other. But when you understand the business model, you understand everything. You can beat your chances. This company is coming up. So that's another thing to look out for. Which are the sectors? So it's not all the sectors you invest in. You might not, it's not composite that you invest in electric. It's not composite that you invest in this. Invest in the sector that you understand, that you can even analyze. Because to do a good investment, you can't buy a stock and you have no idea what the company does. If you have a portfolio and you have this stock, you may not necessarily need to be explaining in detail, but this one that's like, okay, that you have this stock, you should be able to say something. That, okay, I have this stock because of this, and that. So you have to understand. So pick fashion. Fashion is not really a hot sector. It's not really hot. Everybody wear clothes, obviously, Gucci and everything, but people don't really invest in those. It's not really hot. It's not like a hot sector like that. Yes, people buy clothes, people buy fancy things, but there are not many. Yes, there are some fashion companies in the stock market, but those ones are more of retail. Example, you have Under Armour. There are clothing wears, yeah, Under Armour. There are some department stores, Macy's is a department, they sell clothes and everything. So they are not good, but there's no really hot demand for that sector. So fashion, yeah, you might make some money in the, but you can, example, now you cannot compare fashion with tech. You cannot compare fashion with electric vehicles. Electric vehicles beat fashion anytime, any day in terms of the stock market. You cannot compare fashion with fintech. Yes, people wear clothes, but they're not really interested in that sector. Not like you cannot invest there. You can, obviously, people invest. Even Louis Vuitton, although it's not, they're not listed in the US market, but their shares are public. But it's not really a hot sector per se. Yeah, Wale electric vehicle is hot. Adidas is good. Not like you should invest, but yeah. Like example, now if you're a sports fan, you can choose to invest in Adidas if you want. They have good track record, like one of the biggest. I think they're the second largest after Nike. Nike is first, number one, then Adidas number two. So, but the Adidas now is not a growth stock. Not like you cannot invest in Adidas, not like you cannot make your money, but Adidas is already, like, they're already stable and everything. So you can either go for Adidas, for maybe you just want to invest in it, you simply, doesn't mean they will not still grow. Adidas will still grow, Nike will still grow, but you cannot compare those growths with the likes of. Exactly, Chima. Fashion will be better in terms of dividend stock instead of capital appreciation. Perfectly. That's what I wanted to talk about in Adidas and Nike. These ones are best for dividend stocks because Adidas is, I think, it should be about over 100 years. Over 100. So these companies, they've grown, they're this stable, they're big, they're large. So not like they will not still grow, but the growth is reduced. It cannot just grow rapidly compared to a stock that is just growing. Everything is different. So those ones are best for dividend stocks. So it basically depends on how high the demand that determines the perfectly. Thank you. Even this question. Okay, Christopher, I'll talk about it. So what you said, Omolola, that it basically depends on how high the demand is that determines the profit. Perfectly. Now, my own personal investment strategy, because I'm still young, I'm just 25, I'm still young, I have more time on my side and everything. So I look for growth stocks. Because in a way, it's best to buy into the stock of a company when there is no noise. When there's no noise, when nobody's talking about them, that is the best time to buy. If you analyze this company for the future, like that is the buy when nobody needs them. So you are entering nobody needs them. When the noise is already out, that everybody's talking about them, is already late to buy. Because those that are very bought before the noise, because when the noise starts, that's where FOMO sets in. FOMO is fear of missing out. So there are people that they are buying, but this is very good. I don't want to miss out. Let me enter. They buy. All those demand and everything, it pushes the price upward. So, for example, now there are some stocks in my portfolio that are like future stock. I'm buying them now when nobody really needs them. Nobody really needs them now, so I'm buying them. By the time people now start talking about them, I'll have been making my good money. So you have to be able to see the future of your company before you buy. If you're buying into a company that has no future, you're wasting money. Thank you. Thank God you're a lady. So when a guy asks a lady out, one of the things ladies do is that they analyze the guy. They look into the future of the guy. Will this guy have money? Will he be able to take care of me? Will he be able to give me the marriage or the life that I want? They look at those things. So if they say that, John will not give me anything. John doesn't have money. He doesn't have anything. He's poor. Is that? And they look at Andrew. Andrew may not really have the money, but Andrew has prospects. Yes, Andrew is hardworking. The money is not yet showing now, but Andrew is hardworking. He's striving. He's hustling. He's this. Is that? He has done so many things. I believe in Andrew. Let me answer Andrew. I'm dating Andrew. And once you say that, yes, Andrew, big break has already come. They're happy. So how does a company's profit making translate to an increase in stock value? Like I said earlier, the company is there to make money. They are there to make money. So if the company is making good profits, one, it is increasing the market capitalization of the company. That is the total value. There'll be more demand for the stock. Because the company is doing well, fundamentally, they are growing, they are making their money, the revenue is increasing, profit is getting better, the debt is reducing. There'll be more demand for the stock because people would want to buy into it. Because everybody buys into a good company. They are buying into something that has future. And if they are not making money or there's no sign you would make money, then the future is really bright. So if the future is better, yes, either this company is making money now or they have things that they've already put in place that, yes, this company would make money. This company will be profitable and everything. it affects the stock price because they are making money. There's more optimism. People are buying into the stock. The stock is doing well. They are gaining more prominence, like the leader in that industry. It would reflect the stock price. As the business grows, the stock price would meet up with it. So when the company's profit making is doing well and everything, it would show in the stock price. Now, if the company is not really making profit, if they are not really making profit, it would also show in the stock price. Because if they are losing money repeatedly and everything, revenue is going down, they are gazing ground, there will be demand for the stock. Because people are like, this company is losing. Is losing ground. They are not really making money. Who would pull out their money? Because nobody wants to invest in what is not sure or what there's no standard to be sure. Nobody wants to invest in something that they would lose their money or that has no prospect and everything. So if they are seeing that this company is losing money regularly and everything, the financials is poor, they will not want to put their money in it. Because at that point, the risk is now very, very high. Can the management direct the price of the stock? This is how I would answer that question. They can influence the price of the stock based on their actions. Now, there's something that is called insider buying, whereby those in the management team decide to buy the stock of the company. At the beginning of this class, I said that I gave an example of the employee and investor, that the Coca-Cola CEO, though he's an employee, he's also an investor. He has shares in Coca-Cola. So if part of the management team is buying more shares of the company, it would affect the price. So they are not necessarily saying that, okay, Coca-Cola is 20. We want it to be 50 or 100. It's more like an indirect approach based on the actions that they take. So the actions that are taken is what is directing the price of the stock. So they are not necessarily saying that, okay, yes, we are pushing it up. No, they are making some decisions, and those decisions is reflecting the price. So if, for example, part of the management team, they are buying more shares of the company because they are public, so every information is public, you can hide anything. So if they are buying more shares, it kind of gives investors confidence that this management team, they are buying more shares of the company. It means they are believing more in the company. So if the management is believing, me as an investor, I can believe. The management trusts that, okay, we are in the... It's just example. Let me go back to football, for example. So for those who watch football, something, there are times that you hear that a player has signed a new deal with the club. So whether his deal was supposed to expire by 2023, but because of his performance, he's doing well, he's scoring goals, he's performing and everything, the club decided that, okay, let us renew this contract. We are extending your deal, we are giving you a new deal. So that alone, for the fans, for the football fans, that is more like a confidence booster that, okay, our best player is leaving. We are tying down our best player. Messi is not in Barcelona. We are tying him down. We are giving him more contracts. So that gives the fans confidence that, okay, thank God Messi is coming back. We would enjoy Messi in this coming season. It also reflects in the stock market too. So if the management team are buying more shares of the company, the investors are happy that, because they know that people don't put their money in what they don't like or what they don't trust. So for the management to be to add more share of that, to increase their position, it means they are believing in the company. They know that they're in the right direction. They also want to make their money. So with that, it will reflect in the price. Because with that, since investors have seen that the management team has increased their position, they are buying more shares, there will be more demand for the stock. Because the insiders, they know what they are doing. They are seeing something, they are buying into it. So everybody too wants to buy. There's now more demand for the stock. So the price increases. So the price is increasing based on the actions that the management is taking. So they didn't just change the price that, okay, it is 20, tomorrow they flip everything. No, it's the actions that they are taking that is affecting the price. So that's how management can influence the price of a stock based on their actions, based on what they do, the decisions that they make and everything. So another question. There's one ID. So, Benedict, I think I've answered your question. How does the company's profit making translate to increasing stock? Yes, Omolola, we have to see into the future of. Okay, yes, Christopher. So I think, yeah, you said your connection was having issues. I already explained that at the beginning, but because of Christopher, I'm going to explain it again. Difference between dividend and capital appreciation. Okay, yes, Benedict, I'm going to talk about the ANC. Let's talk about it. So, Christopher, the difference between capital appreciation and dividend yield. Capital appreciation is when the price of your stock is going up, in the sense that you are buying a stock with the hope to sell it at a higher price. So as the stock price increases, we can decide to sell it. So capital appreciation, there are two different ways to make your money. So with capital as appreciation, you buy a stock, then you sell it at a higher price. Just like the typical market, the typical buying and selling. So you buy maybe products, you buy clothes at maybe like those that sell clothes on WhatsApp or something. You go to Balogun, you buy clothes at a low price, you make a bargain, you buy, so then you now resell at a higher price. So the difference between your cost price and your selling price is now your profit. It happens with the stock market too. It's basic economics. So you buy, maybe you buy Tesla at $10 now. Tesla has increased to $30. You are selling. That's capital appreciation. The capital is appreciating. The price is appreciating. So as it's going up, whatever, whenever you sell, you have a profit margin. For dividends, dividends is more like, dividend means the payment of part profits to the shareholders. So when a company makes money, they make profits, they give the kind of reward that invest, because they're making use of investors' money. So they reward the investors with a percentage of the profit. More like, we've already made money. We are, let us share part of the money. You take this, you take this, you take this. So how much money you make, how much dividends you get, depends on how much money you invest. Somebody that has that invested $1 million in a stock, and another person invested $200,000 in a stock, they will not get the same dividends. The percentage will be the same, but the amount will differ, because this person has more money. Example, 5% of 1 million is higher than 5% of 100,000. So dividends and appreciation, capital appreciation, are two ways by which you make money in the stock market. So it's either you buy with a growth stock that, okay, you sell at a higher price, or you buy and you get some quarterly dividends. So they give you a big part of the profits that they make and everything. So that is how it works. For dividends, for example, I made use of real estate as an example. You buy a property for, let's say, 40 million naira, and you now put it out for rent. Obviously, you know that you cannot rent that house for 40 million naira. It's not possible. So now, depending on maybe location and everything and the likes, you maybe you bought it 40 million, then you're now renting it out for, let's say, 300,000 per year or 400,000 per year, something like that. So in a way, that's how dividends work. So you've bought it, you're now getting your yearly rent. You are collecting your rent. So that's how it is with dividends. You are collecting your quarterly dividends and everything. So that is it. I hope you understand, Christopher. So Benedict, the recent rally on AMC stock has really left me confused as to one thing. Is there a rule of thumb for picking questions? Now, the discussion of AMC goes beyond the scope of this class, because for me to explain AMC fully, we would have to talk about short squeeze and advanced discussion, which is beyond the scope of this class. So we don't really talk about short squeeze. During my boot camp that I hold at Sheraton Hotel, that's when I discussed about those ones, short squeeze and everything. But for AMC, like I said, when I was answering Priye about handling your emotions. Remember, I gave the example of relationship. A guy is dating a girl. The girl is beautiful and everything, but there are still more beautiful girls than the girl. But it doesn't mean you should pursue after that girl. In a relationship, nothing is wrong with a relationship. She loves you, you love her. She values you, you value her. You guys are good together. Even if there's another person that is, maybe she's more endowed than your girlfriend. Maybe she has more breasts or she has more this than your girlfriend. You need to move to there. Be okay with your relationship. You now shut your eyes on those ones. Yeah, I do committed to this relationship. So even if another girl is teasing you, she's showing you laps, showing you cleavage and everything, you don't need to be disturbed. That is where focus comes in. That is where discipline comes in. So AMC is rallying doesn't mean you should buy AMC. You can decide to ignore and stick to your strategy. Because as always, you should stick to your strategy. So the fundamentals behind the good stock still remains. This AMC is a, will I say, is a loophole. Like I said, it's beyond the scope of this class. So I'm not going to explain much about AMC. It goes beyond the scope of this class. It's kind of an advanced something. I need to take my time to explain that. So leave AMC. Like if AMC, fine, it is valid. Let it rally. Stick to your own analysis and your own research. Because no matter which stock you buy, there's always one stock that will increase more than your own. It doesn't mean you should pursue them. It doesn't mean you should pursue them. Going back to the relationship that I talked about, for example, you are with a girl. She's beautiful and everything. You're in a relationship. So this girl is now, maybe you go out or something, or you went for a party or something. Then you now see one girl, she's now showing you laps and everything. Because she's fine. You went to go and meet that one. You slept with her. You go to another function. You see one other girl. You sleep with her. You are sleeping with every girl that you see because they are fine, because they are beautiful and everything. One day, you will catch HIV. One day, you will catch syphilis or gonorrhea. Because we are just jumping from one place to another. Every girl that passed has big good. You would have disease and everything. It's the same thing with the stock market. Because every stock is rallying, doesn't mean you should buy them. So if AFC, like, you should increase 4,000% in one day, that is business. Maintain your stock that it is doing on well. The fundamentals are okay. Everything is okay. Fine. You go ahead. The stock is fine. Let's gain whatever it wants to gain. Your own is going well. As far as nothing is wrong with your own, except if there's something wrong with your own stock. Like I said the other time, I gave my analysis. Exactly. Maintain your baby. Thank you, Jago. Maintain your baby. Like I said, with the analysis of something, except if your boyfriend is beating you, except if your girlfriend is cheating on you, she's disrespecting you, she's nagging, she's this, is that, and it's becoming unbearable, then leave your relationship. You cannot go and check the one that has been eyeing you since. So this one is eyeing you, but yeah, your relationship. Now the relationship has already crashed and everything. You cannot say, okay, this girl that has been showing me laps, that has been kissing with me, let me see if she has sense. Okay, she has sense and everything. She's even better than this one I've been dating, I've been wasting my time. I've already moved. You are there. If you understand my relationship explanation. So that is how it works. A girl is more beautiful than your girlfriend. Trust me, you should quit it. A guy has more money than your boyfriend. Doesn't mean you should leave your boyfriend and go and meet that guy. He's spending money on you and everything, doesn't mean you would be a good husband. Like I said at the beginning, a stock is going up doesn't mean it's a good stock. A stock is going down doesn't mean it is bad. So you have a boyfriend that is earning maybe 300K per month. The relationship is fine. He's doing you well. He's treating you well and everything. All well and good. But because of your ojukokoro, your boyfriend doesn't have a car, but he's working hard. He's doing his things well. He's making plans and everything. One guy now comes because the guy has 6 packs. He has beard gang and everything. He's gymming. He has G-Wagon. He's using iPhone 12. He comes. He shows you body. And I say, ah, this guy has body. You got to meet him. he buys shawarma for you, he take you to Kubana, he does this. At the end of the day, he now beats you. Which one is worse? So he's spending money on you, doesn't mean he loves you. He's spending money for you on you, doesn't mean he's going to be a good husband. Because we've heard of situations whereby a lady marries a rich guy, and at the end of the day, the guy is maltreating her. So he has money, doesn't mean he would be a good husband to you. The same thing with the stock market. A stock is going up, doesn't mean you should buy it. Except if the one that you have is not doing well, you've analyzed everything, nothing can work out, then you can decide to exit this and go for another one. Now, you are going for the guy that is buying you. It should not necessarily be because he has money. Because you have money today, anything can happen tomorrow and you lose your money. A stock is going up today. Even if you are to leave a stock, maybe you sell a stock and you go for this one. The rally can be a catalyst because obviously you need a rally. Obviously, we need one relationship that will be taken care of. So even if a guy has more money than your boyfriend, you can still leave your boyfriend and go for the guy. I'm not endorsing it, but I'm using it as an example. Now, you go for the guy, doesn't mean you suffer. Like they say that we should start thinking Nollywood, that you left me when I had no money. Okay, she left you for a guy to make your money. Let someone leave their boyfriend and come and meet you. So a stock is going up, doesn't mean you cannot go there. It can be a catalyst. But you buying that stock should not just be because it's going up. You are leaving your relationship for a guy that has money. It should not necessarily be because he has money. Money is good and everything, but there should be some other underlying factors that accompanies him having more money. Maybe this guy that you are going to meet is more understanding. He listens to you better than your current boyfriend. Maybe he's smarter, or he takes care of you better, or he like I said, he listens to you better, he understands you better. He knows what to do. So those factors are good. Then he now has money on top. So I don't know if you understand. So you living should not just be because he has money. Because if he has money, he will splash money on you. And then he will sit it on you, or he will dump you for another person. So stuff is going up doesn't mean you should go there. It can be a catalyst that, yes, it's going up. Why is it going up? If everything is okay and it is now better than what you currently have, fine, you go there. Even the guys that went to Oba, those that went to Oba, I don't know, that those that went to Oba, I don't go to Oba, I stayed in Lagos. Okay, what is your take on Snapchat and TikTok with regards to stocks? Snapchat is public. Go for Snapchat if you want. They're public. You do your research and everything. If everything is open, fine. You can go for Snapchat. Although TikTok is not public. No, TikTok is owned by one company, buy something, but TikTok is Chinese. Now, thank you for even bringing me to this TikTok. Chinese factor. Remember I talked about external factors. The Chinese, because you know, China has a kind of rich zone. They kind of misbehave, so it can affect the stock price. So no matter what a Chinese company is doing, just because they are Chinese and how volatile and how unpredictable the comments can be, it would affect the stock. So that's one of the examples of the technical factors that I talked about, external factors and everything. A token I held onto for almost a year did 800%. Yes, in the stock market. A lot. Thank you for even bringing me to this part. Patience, focus, and discipline. They are three best friends in the stock market. You need a lot of patience. You need it. Like I said, you are investing in a company. And at the beginning, I said that the investors and the business owner mindset is different from an employee. So someone that runs a business knows that a business doesn't just grow overnight. It takes time. You are investing in a company. So if it takes time for a company to grow, why do you want your stock to just grow overnight? It takes time. Allow the company to grow. You need to be patient. That's where knowledge comes in. knowledge comes in. You need to be patient that this thing would grow. Allow it to grow. You've done your research. So it is not gambling or that maybe, yes, nothing in life is predictable, but with knowledge, you know which one gives you a better chance than others. Even for those in the medical sector, they say that 99%. Because the reason why they are saying it's 99.9, because they know that you cannot, no drug or no antiseptic can 100% give. They put in 99.9%. You cannot just be 100% clean, something like that. So the life is not certain and everything, but knowledge gives you a certain of predictability that you can predict that, okay, based on this available information, this should happen. Not that 100% it would happen, no, but the signs are there that it should happen. And most times it happens. So you need a lot of patience. You need a lot of patience. And also, please and please, do not invest with money that is not your own. Do not borrow to invest. Like I said, sort out your income. So if your income is not enough, sort that out. I talked a lot about this on at my bootcamp when I talked about mindset and everything. Mr. Chima would know about it. He attended my last bootcamp. So I talk about, because like I said, you cannot separate personal finance from investing. So you need to sort out the income, because it's the income that you would use to invest. So if you are not making more money, sort that out. Look for something to do that will give you more income. If you have a job, how do you negotiate for a better salary that will give you more money and everything? You have a business, what do you do to make your business grow that you get more customers to make more money? You have a skill, how, where do you sell? Get that sorted out. Once you have sufficient predictable income. Now, like I said sufficient. It's not until you have 2 million before you start. Like I said, the barrier to entry is low. Because there's a people that when you, because we've seen a lot in this thing, when you talk about investing, they were like, yeah, it's not somebody that has money that will be investing. Hey, can you go again? Those that don't have money, leave them. Those are the people I'm not talking to. I'm talking to those that have the money. If you don't have money, sort that out. Because you cannot be hungry and investing. Sort that out. Set down out. Once you sit down, then you're my audience. I will speak to you. How will you invest money? So do not borrow money to invest, because borrowing money to invest, it puts you under pressure. If you invest your money and it goes down and everything, you know that it will still come back up. You're at peace. But when you borrow money to invest, there's always a timeline. Even if it's your friend, no matter how friendship is, it will get to a stage that, Oga, I need my money. Even if it's never collecting interest, I need my money. What if when they want to collect their money is now when the market is down? What do you do? Your stock is now down. He's asking for the money. What do you do? But when it is your own personal money, nobody is coming to collect the money from you. So you're at peace. It gives you peace. It gives you stability and everything. Do not invest with another person's money. Do not borrow to invest. And those are one of the things that makes people to cry when a Ponzi scheme happens. When the Ponzi scheme crash, because when it starts, everybody say, ah, come on, put your money. Someone got borrow money, go up, borrow money to put. When it now crash, they are crying. Most of the people that cry when a Ponzi scheme crashes or when maybe crypto goes down, most of the people that are crying, they are using borrowed money, they are using school fees money, they are using house rent money. You don't use money to put, because you cannot predict the market. You analyze, like I said. Nothing is 100% sure. You don't want to time the market. Allow time to have its course. So do not invest with money that you need immediately. That's another thing. That's another error people usually make. So what I'm saying that if you don't have enough capital, you should not. No. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying if you don't have money, do not invest. Like I said at the beginning, the barrier to entry is low. With 10,000 naira, you can invest. You can start investing. But what I'm saying is that the money that you are using to invest should not be money that you need immediately, because that will put you under pressure to make as much money as possible to pull out your money. For example, your house rent is due in September. I am trying to use that money to invest in the stock today. What if that stock doesn't grow within that time frame, you'll be under pressure because you need to pay your house rent and the money is in the stock and the stock is down by 10%. It is all lower than your stock. You start being tense and everything. But when you are investing with money that you can, not like do away with, but like I said, personal finance, planning, budgeting, you can't separate that because when you budget very well, you are investing for the future. So even if it is 10,000, be doing that 10,000 regularly. It is not something that you would, I need my money back. You will not grow your portfolio that way. So the more money you have, like I said many times during this class, the bigger your money, the better for you. So you don't need to have, you don't need to wait until you have 2 million naira before you put it in the market. If you are putting in 10,000, okay, for example, let's do this analysis. 100,000 naira and 10,000. If you invest 10,000 naira 10 times, you've already invested 100,000 naira. So you don't need to wait until you have that 100,000 naira before you invest. If you put the 10,000 naira today, maybe 2 weeks later, you put another 10,000. You put another 10,000. It is accumulating. Over a period of time, you would have already invested 100,000. So it's not until when you have that 100,000. Because if you wait until you have that 100,000, you won't be able to invest. Because there's this Parkinson's law that expenses rises to meet income. Like I said, you cannot separate personal first. So if you want to wait until you have that 100,000, maybe you've already accumulated 50,000, there will be one need, there will be one demand, or there will be one something to pay bill, and before you know it, you pull out. At the end of the day, you find out that they are not investing because they are waiting until you get a particular amount. No. The little that you have, be putting it there. But like I said, personal finance, budgeting. You cannot put money that you want to use to eat next week and you're putting it in the market. No, that is foolishness. You don't do that. So you put out money that you can part away with. You are investing for the future because that's what investing is. You are investing for the future to get more money. You are planning for the future and everything. That is the sole purpose of investing. So to get to a point whereby you can make money even if you are not working, like your money is working for you. So it's not that you should have enough capital. It is not real estate, because real estate is kind of expensive. You need to have a certain level of money for you to make good, no matter how deals and everything, nothing less than 100,000 to make good investments in the real estate. So real estate is, the barrier to entry is a bit high. For stocks, low, 10,000, 20,000, you can put there. So it's not money that you would need immediately. Maybe over a period of 6 months, it has yielded a good return. Fine, you can decide to pull out your money. Oh, well, it has yielded something. You want to buy a phone. You've made some good profits from the stock market. You can decide to pull out some money to meet some needs, either to buy a phone or vacation or bills or whatever it is. So I don't know if it gets me pretty. I'm not saying that until you have a particular amount before you invest. Like I said earlier on, the higher your money, the better for you. But not until you have that before you can start. Have a plan. Budgeting. Settle your income first. You are making a particular amount. Fine. Pull out some money. Instead of you saving like the money saving, probably you are putting it in an investment vehicle. You are buying stocks and everything. You are buying, you're adding more. At the period of time, it should accumulate big. The more your money, the better your profits. I don't know if you understand me. So, like I said, patience and everything. So, I'm going to send some recommended stocks to us in the group. I'm going to send some recommended stocks to us in the group, which we would use to get started with. So, does anyone... it's already past 3. Imagine, 1 hour late. So, I'm not dissolving the group. So, the group is... forever. So discussions will continue then. If you have any question, everything, the conversation continues in the group and everything. So any question or whatever, open group discussion and everything, I'll be sending some stocks to us for which we started with. Another thing, I just went back because I was thinking of Microsoft. Now, you are buying a stock, like I'm making reference now to those, like, I think Christopher sends, should we buy Snapchat or should I buy Adidas or those TikTok and everything? You don't buy a stock because it is popular. It is popular doesn't mean you should buy it. And that's one of the mistakes people make, especially when they are starting investing. So they are starting with investing. The first stock that they are buying Apple, they are buying Amazon, they are buying this. Don't buy a stock because it is popular. Buy a stock because it has potential for growth. Not like popular stocks don't have potential for growth. They obviously are, but they are buying that stock because there are some people that are like that. Why do you have Microsoft? Because I know Microsoft, that I'm buying it. No. If you are buying a stock because you just know the stock, you don't know why you are buying it. When the market is down, you don't know what to do and you decide to sell when you should have held on to that stock. You don't know how to handle your emotions because you don't even know why you bought it. You are just buying name. It is popular doesn't mean it is the best stock. It is popular doesn't mean you should buy it. You should buy it because your analysis is okay. It matches your conviction and everything. That's why you should buy it. So not just because Microsoft is there. Those are the stocks that we know. That the popular, that the more popular stocks and everything doesn't mean you should buy it. And doesn't mean you should not buy it. But the point I'm making that there must be a reason why you're buying this stock. I have Microsoft stock. There's a reason I bought it. One of the reasons, because they are into gaming. Microsoft is the owner of Xbox. And like I said, gaming is one of the things that's one of the sectors that will boom in the next few years. And Xbox is huge. After PlayStation and Xbox, they are huge. So Microsoft is the owner, I'm buying them. Microsoft is the owner of Azure. That Azure is a very big, is a cloud computing software. Cloud storage is big, and I'm talking about cloud storage too. Microsoft is into video conferencing. No, we have Zoom. There's Microsoft Teams and everything. They are big there too. So these are, you can see now, these are reasons why I'm buying Microsoft. So I'm not just buying Microsoft because of name. I'm not buying Microsoft because it's Bill Gates that founded Microsoft. No, I'm buying Microsoft because of what they are doing and the potential of what they are doing to make the company to grow in the future. That is the reason. So you don't just buy a stock because it's popular or because everyone's talking about it. Buy it because you've done your research and you know what you are doing. The company has future and everything. Does anyone have any question? Very excited, 3 o'clock. So, time for question and answers. Let me unmute everyone. So, if I have any question, ask. So, I will begin to wrap up this class. We spent 3 hours already. Are you guys listening? Hope I've not been talking to myself alone. I'm not seeing any comments. Does anyone have any question?
No, no.
No question. There's no question. We'll begin to round up.
I have a question.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, so first, thank you for the session. It was worth the time. Thank you so much. It was amazing. Okay, so my question is, the initial recommendation is this. You know, if you're a startup, you should start with capital
appreciation stocks.
Yeah, capital appreciation stocks. Yeah. Then the idea is after you gather enough capital, and then you can now start investing in dividend stocks, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, but someone like you now, what time frame are you willing to actually, what time frame are you willing to give out to play the capital appreciation stock game, and then before you move into the dividend stock game?
So. Thank you. Now, to answer this question, two things are involved. One, It depends on your age bracket and also the money you have. Because, example, if I have $5,000, I can decide to buy some dividend stocks, even if I'm 25. If I even have $1,000, I can decide to buy some dividend stocks. This is my talk about dividends, that you need like a good, maybe at least sufficient money, maybe $1,000 or something. It gives you better profits and everything. So, let's say rigid time frame that it must get to this before you buy dividend stocks. No, that was just an advice and recommendation from me. You can decide to use $100 to buy dividend stocks, your money and everything. It's all yours. So there's no time. It's not until maybe you have $1 million or. My emphasis was that you need the sufficient money, like maybe $500 or $1,000 to get good money or good returns from your dividends. If you put in $20 or $30, you still get your dividend, but the amount will be very little compared to someone that has $500 or $1,000. So it's not maybe until you get to age 40 or 50 before you start buying dividend stocks. No. Depends on your risk tolerance too. Even people that are young, that they start them, they don't have the risk tolerance to accommodate capital appreciation stocks, because capital appreciation stocks tend to be volatile because they are still growing, so the ups and down and everything. There's some people that they don't have the mind to accommodate that. Fine, you can go for dividend stocks, you can go for ETFs, they're a bit stable. Not like they do not experience up and downs, but that can be compared to capital appreciation stocks. So it depends on the money you have, how much you have. Like, okay, let me just give, this is my own, it's not official law, but this is my own like benchmark recommendation. If you don't have at least $500 to spend on a stock, you don't need to buy a dividend stock. This is my own recommendation. That person may say different thing. That's them. But for me, if you don't have $500 to buy a dividend stock, there's no need to buy a dividend stock. If you don't have $500. The less than 500 that you have, put it in the good stock and allow it to grow. That's just my own logic behind this. So it's not like that maybe until you reach or you've been in the market for 4 years before you buy dividend. No, no, not until you reach, you have $1 million or until you have 40. Everything is relative. So the idea is that capital appreciation stocks helps your money to grow. So the example I gave of Coca-Cola and Tesla, I shared my screen and we saw that and everything. So there's no rigid law and everything. Just, but for me personally, get the best out of it. If you don't have $500 to put in a dividend stock, then it's of no use. Just buy capital appreciation stocks. So that is that. So Omola, how do I get started, please? So this is how to get started. Download, install Bamboo app. Download it, install. You register. It's very user-friendly, it's easy to understand. So just put in your name, details. Just, they'll be asking you some questions. Just using your BVN or NIN. Those are one of the two that they'll use to verify your details and everything. You put in your bank account, you open it, you register. So I have little cash to invest. Now, little cash is relative, but as far as you have at least 10,000, you are good to go. $10,000, you are good to go. I say $10,000, sorry. $10,000, I'm used to mentioning dollars. $10,000, that is $20. That is the barest minimum. So as far as you can have the barest minimum, you are good to go. It's not until you have $200,000 before you invest in stock markets, no. It's not till you have 100,000 before you buy stocks. No, it's not till you have 5 million. 10,000 is the minimum. 10,000 naira, and obviously everyone here has 10,000 at some point or the other to spare to invest. So, can I do capital investment stock and dividend? Yes, you can do that at the same time. You can do that. It's not because that all your stocks are capital. You can have some capital appreciation. But thank you for coming to this. You don't need to buy everything. like I said, you don't need to spread yourself thin. Just focus on little. This, your, how much money you make in the stock market is not a function of how many stocks you have. Because people make this mistake a lot, especially newbies that are starting out. They want to buy a stock, they're investing, they start with maybe $50 and they're buying 200 stocks with $50. How? So just buy whether one, two, or three, just little, give yourself that, okay, this is what I want to buy. Concentration matters because, like I said, the more money you have, the better. So even if it is little money that you have, you need to spread it to 20. Just concentrate it on a little and allow it to grow. And with that, you will make your good money. So I believe I've answered your question. Does anyone have any other question? Do you mind recommending some stocks you have invested in the past and they've paid off? Yes. Okay. Let me mention it here. I've invested in so many stocks that have given some good returns. Now, this is not a recommendation to buy. I'm just giving an example. So some of these stocks, they've given me some 100%, some 200%, some 400%, some 50%, some. There are so many stocks that have paid off. So many are different time frame. Depends on the stock, the sector, and the state of the economy has different time frame and everything. So that is that. No one have another question before we call this. Does anyone have a question? Does anyone have any question? Chago is just not present. No, I can mute. So you recommend that we don't withdraw money? Yes. Yeah. Okay. When is it okay to withdraw? Like I said at the big at one point that personal finance works with investing. So if you want to withdraw your money, the question is, why are you withdrawing your money? Is there an urgent need that you want to meet? Okay, this is it. Now, you want to withdraw money. Why do you want to withdraw the money? For what? Why do you want to withdraw the money? What you want to buy or what is the money? Can it wait? Because like I said, personal finance. And when you talk about personal finance, you talk about budgeting, delaying gratification and everything. You talk about needs. You talk about needs and wants and everything. So you can't just withdraw money and say, okay, because I just want to be having money in my clinic. There must be a reason why you want to invest. You want to withdraw that money. What do you want to use it for? Yes, it's your money. I'm not saying you should not withdraw, but personal finance, what do you want to buy? You can't wait because you are creating an asset with the stock market. You are not just buying stock and you are creating an asset. So, if you want to withdraw money, what, why? I'm not asking you that, but this is the question you should ask yourself. Okay, you are withdrawing not because you can decide to sell your stock and still leave your money in bamboo. You are selling it doesn't mean you withdraw it out into your bank account. You can still leave it in the app. You can still sell your stock and leave it there, fine. But if you want to withdraw your money into your own bank account, you need to ask yourself, why do you want to withdraw the money? What do you want to use it for? These are personal finance questions. It's not something I would ask you that, but putting your wants and needs and everything. Let me allow Shea to say something. So Shea is my very good friend and business partner.
All right, guys, how are you doing? Good afternoon. So let me just quickly say something about the question that Omolala asked. The truth is that if you seek for a reason, you always get a reason. So I was talking with a friend of mine yesterday, and he told me he withdrew some money from his bamboo to do something in the house. And I said, see, I can relate it to you because I'm also your firstborn. And I told him that, see, there are some times that there was something wrong in the house and he didn't have money and nobody died. The only reason why you should withdraw your money from your bamboo is someone dying or is someone in police case? Is there a police case? Because the truth is that if you are always, if you seek for a reason, you won't get a reason. All right. Don't give yourself that opportunity to have a reason. Okay. Now, there will be a time you need to withdraw your money to maybe go for vacation. But the question is, set the standard very high for yourself. All right. If you are going to be very successful, if you are going to be very rich, I'm talking from the aspect of financial management. It is not making the money that matters. It is managing the money that matters. All right. Set a very high standard for yourself. Tell yourself, okay, the only way I will remove money from this is if I should eat. The only way I will remove small profit to enjoy myself is if I should make a total profit of 10 million naira or 5 million naira or, you know, depending on how much you have, right? So if you always seek for a reason, you always get a reason. All right. Now, the reason why you should not always seek for an opportunity to withdraw your money is because I was going to say that once you put your first money into bamboo, please don't stop putting money into bamboo. Right? Make it be addicted to putting money into bamboo. As a matter of fact, see bamboo as any money that goes there does not come out. The time to come out is if someone is dying or someone has a police case. It's going to help you. It helped me. It helped Nathaniel. Because there will be some opportunities in the market that if you take advantage of, because you have more money, your profit is going to be crazy. So, for example, if you have, so when we did CCIV earlier this year, and we got about 400 to 600%. Someone that had $50, all right, or someone that had $100, if 100% has $400, all right. Someone that has made it a point of duty to always put money into bamboo and has grown his or her portfolio to say $1,000. The same 400% is going to give crazy, you know. So please, I beg you, in the name of God, if you are going to be, see, delay all of these problems. There will always be family problems. There will always be everything to. There will always be problems. Basically, at the end of the day, if you should delay this thing, you'll be very happy at the end of the day because later in life you have a lot of capital that have transformed. You've done capital gains on. And now you can now say to everybody when there's a problem. You know, but see, now don't allow the firstborn complex overwhelm you. Don't allow the firstborn complex. Don't allow the savior complex. That's the word. Savior complex. Because you have the money in bamboo, because you have the money in a piggy vest save lock. You're not gonna break it. I'm saying this because most of us are very young. Most of us here are not married. I don't think there's anyone that is married yet. Someone is married. Wait. Most of us here are not married. And the idea of not being married or staying, yes, don't play God in people's life. The idea of not marrying or staying single is an opportunity for you to build. Congratulations, Mr. Wally.
He's the one I was talking about that is married.
You're the winner. All right. So the idea of you delaying gratification. So for Mr. Walid right now, he can now use bamboo as a form. So how much am I paying for school fees for my boys every year? All right. So he can now decide to put a particular amount, all right, to now get returns on for that particular school fees. All right. But see, if you are single right now, all right, you're still living in your father's house or your mother's house or your whatever house you live in, please. The aim is to maintain and multiply the money, not to just withdraw. How much profit have you made? You know, someone makes profit, someone makes 100% profit from $50 and you want to withdraw $50. What is that? Are you joking? What are you doing? All right. Even if you have $1,000 and you made a profit of $100, that's, you now made $1,000. That's not an excuse for you to what's it called? To withdraw the money. All right, I was in my billionaire mentor this morning and he made an example of, like, last month I was in his hotel, we're talking, and I told him I had to change my phone. All right, he said, go and change it now. I said, no, not now. It's not, so I don't have the money. I have millions in bamboo, but it's not a pain point for me. It's not a criteria for me right now. As a matter of fact, I'm even looking for more money to put into bamboo. Nathaniel, you know what I'm talking about. Gloria know what I'm talking about. I'm looking for more money to put in new bubbles so that because there's an opportunity we are taking advantage of right now. All right. So this is not the time to withdraw. By the time the opportunity, you know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah. By the time the opportunity, you know, then I can now say, okay, I've tried though. Let me just take 1 naira, you know. But please, I want you to know that there will always be problems. There will always be issues that you need to solve. If you don't, we can't take the opportunity because it's a bit too late for you right now, right? If it was last month, then it will have been better. If this meeting was last month, I would have told you about the opportunity. I think Nathaniel told it to people that attended the last month edition, right? So we can't tell you right now because it's a little too late and we don't want to be the one that gave you that advice. So please note that bamboo as a no-go area unless someone is dying or someone has police case, all right? So I just want to just chip that in, all right? At the end of the day, you'll be happy with yourself. Delay some problems right now so you can solve better problems later. There will always be problems, believe me. There will always be problems. There were times when Nathaniel was broke, I was broke, but we had money in bamboo, right? That we were not going to touch, okay? We're not going to touch it, okay? And today we are happy because now when problems come, We now have enough money even outside of bamboo to even attend to those kind of problems. All right. So please, I beg. I just gonna beg you guys. This is not joking. As a matter of fact, for me, I go off when I just see that someone just I understand we have problems, but for me, I just feel that this is serious. You never get ready to get money in the long term. All right. You make there's a problem and you just withdraw it and you know, I have something like that. Once I know you like that, I don't take it serious. I mean, you'll never hear a word from me again. So that's just for me. I just want to just keep that in. Please, delay gratification, all right? Delay gratification. This is not the time to flex. You don't need money now. You need money when you cannot work again. When you don't have, when your youthfulness is no more there, that's when you need money. You don't need money right now. This is the time to use your energy to get the money. By the time you are, you now have boys like Mr. Wally, all right? You can now, be spreading, all right? But right now, you don't need money, believe me, all right? And believe me, once you have money, problems always come. I got a text message from my mom like some minutes ago. It's money. Problems always come. And so please delay gratification. Right? You have the money does not mean by the time you spread yourself out, you attend to all the problems. Who will not attend to you when you don't have money again? And so I just feel it's just chip down. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shay. So like what Shay said, the last time I withdrew money from my portfolio was around April. That was the last time. And that was because I was preparing for my bootcamp at Sheraton and I needed some money. And that's one thing you will help the needy on you. Because thank you very much, Ogawale. You help the needy on you yourself become the needy. So like I was saying, the last time was in April. And that was because I needed to spend some money based on logistics for hosting people at Sheraton. That was the last time. Like I said in a post recently that see investing as an orchard. So orchard is more like a plantation of trees and everything. Once you do that, once you are building, you have your first tree. You don't need to eat the profit immediately. Build. If you get to a point, you will have plenty, you can decide to. To even answer this question, Omolola, remember I talked about capital appreciation and dividend yield. That capital appreciation, the companies reinvest the money that they make. Not like they cannot give shareholders money. Not like they cannot give dividend, but the money would serve better if they reinvest it back. When they've now grown very well, they can afford to now be giving dividends. So see that with your personal finance. Your quote-unquote, your company like you yourself, you are still growing. You cannot afford to be paying out dividends now. Reinvest the money back into the company. Reinvest. You get to a state that your company, that is you yourself, you will have grown so big that you cannot afford to be giving dividends. You can afford to be giving out money as at. This personal finance is a really big issue. So it's in a way, it's beyond the scope of this class. We discussed it at my bootcamp holding at Sheraton. Then we discussed the full detail. Because like I said, you cannot separate personal finance from investing. So when it comes to the personal finance issue, it's a topic on and it's beyond the scope of this class. So I'll give more details about the bootcamp in the group, so how you can plan and prepare to attend. Then we'll discuss everything in detail, because you cannot separate personal finance with investing. Because at the end of the day, the reason why you're investing is to get more money and to spend it. But how to now manage all those processes is a big discussion on its own, and it's beyond the scope of this class. But you need to get gratification. You're building, you're investing in an asset. Use your time to do your work, like your income. Get that one sorted out. If you need to grow your business, grow it. If you need to negotiate for a better salary, do that. Settle that one out. You cannot be investing when you're hungry. Settle that one out. But as you're investing, don't just be withdrawing money from your portfolio. Don't just, because you've made 100%. How much is 100%? There are some people that have made 3,000%. There are some people that have been investing in Tesla since when Tesla was $50. They've not removed $1 from their portfolio till now. They've never removed $1. They've gained 3,000%. They've not removed $1. It's still there. When they will need to remove that money? So you made 50%. You now to withdraw your money. What then? What else are you now doing? So that's, like I said, this topic is big and is beyond the scope of this class. So for the you guys were saying we should tell you the opportunity. The opportunity has already gone. Like I said earlier on during this discussion, that you buy a stock when the noise is not there. When everybody starts talking about it, when the noise is already there, it's already too late. And would not want you to buy a stock and you will not make as much profit. Like the stock we are talking about now, me and Shei, we bought it when it was around $14 or $10. Now it is already over, it's almost $40. So you buying $40 at $40 now, you cannot compare your profit to we that we had the stock since when it was low. So at this point, it's already late. Don't worry, there are other recommendations, there are other stocks to buy. Like I said, there will always be another beautiful girl out there. There will always be another beautiful girl. So you need to get this opportunity. The opportunity, there's an out. There's always a moving train. You miss this flight, there's another flight that's coming in the evening. So don't bother about that. So does anyone have another question before we wrap? We've already spent almost 2 hours beyond our schedule. So we all are going to get the recordings and everything. But does anyone have any other question before we wrap up? Any question? Does anyone? If there's no question, check up. Let us know. Start with wind up the session. Okay. What stock are not noiseless now? Okay, like I said, I would send some stock recommendations to you in the group. I'll send it in the group, so you get that in the group. I'll send it to the group. So that's not that. I'm going to send it in the group. So don't need to bother. I'll send the stocks to the group and everything. So you guys are going to buy your stocks. Don't worry, you're going to make your money. That is not an issue. So does anyone have another question? If there's no question, we can wrap up. Time has gone. So I'm still waiting. Or should I close? Should we wrap up? So since no one is talking, I guess we can wrap up. So the conversation still goes on in the group. The conversation goes up. I'm going to send some recommendations to you. Then I'm still going to discuss about the bootcamp, because what example now, my bootcamp is usually 70,000. This one is just an online short course. So definitely you cannot get everything here. Like the guy that asked about the AMC and everything, there's an explanation behind AMC that is a topic on its own. I discussed that at my bootcamp. The personal finance issue that we're addressing with Omolola, there's a big discussion on this one. So I'm going to give you guys details later on how you can benefit from it. It's beyond the scope of this class, but the conversation still continues in the group. Once you register with your details, deposit your money, we'll be having the discussions. So, yes, Joseph, we can round up. Yeah, we can wrap up. So, thank you, guys. Thank you for coming. And I trust you had a very good session. You can share the story online on social media. You can tag me or whatever. So thank you, guys. So I'm going to save it now and everything. Once the recording is available, I'll send it to the group. So thank